Those of you who've been listening to the broadcast that we've been having on KFJC since about 1979, 1980, know that we have talked at great length and in almost nauseating detail, nauseating at least to any citizen with an ounce of scruples and belief in good government, about the connections between our intelligence establishment and not only ours, of course, but many intelligence establishments and the drug trade. The fact that as the intelligence establishments began to become things unto themselves after World War II, and as they began to go with a policy of basically the Cold War policy of continuous engagement at low level, and as is becoming even more important in the Reagan 1980s, when the whole Cold War philosophy of small brush fire wars has become the order of the day, well, it's very difficult to fund these types of wars with through normal, legitimate, and legal political means, because most of the American people don't want to see their representatives voting for things like aid to the Contras, aid to the Mujahideen above a certain amount, things of that nature. And especially they don't want to see people supporting, say, the White Hand death squads in El Salvador and Guatemala and places like that, which many times our intelligence and political establishments have felt to be the order of the day for continuing their anti-communist political philosophies. And as a result, they have to go elsewhere for money and undetectable sums of money. And they found that the best ways to do this are gun running, drug running, or combinations thereof. And we have spent the last several months on these Radio Free America broadcasts looking in quite a bit of depth at how that has come to evolve as a national strategy, especially for the United States, but also for the Western nations in general.
Now, on this evening's broadcast, we're going to be taking a look at the intelligence services, particularly the CIA's role in the LSD phenomenon. Once again, we will see the Central Intelligence Agency involved in a pivotal way in the actual trafficking in LSD, and we'll also see the interrelationship between the LSD traffic and the arms traffic, a theme that's become almost numbing and certainly fairly depressing over the quill, as we've examined it over the course of these broadcasts, and indeed I think that could be safely said of the entire overview of the guns and drugs trades, which are in fact one trade and very closely interrelated. On this evening's broadcast, we're going to begin by taking a look at the growth of the LSD phenomenon, specifically the spread of LSD in American society is inextricable with the activities of the CIA and military in the United States. And we're going to begin taking a look at how LSD and its use and testing began out of a CIA program in order that was basically a search for a truth serum. We're going to take a look at the way in which the CIA's research into LSD spurred LSD research all around the country. Then we're going to take a look at the actual growth of the LSD subculture, so to speak. In particular, we're going to take a look at some of the main proponents of LSD, or the use of LSD for recreational purposes. We're going to take a look at a guy named Captain Al Hubbard, who, unlike Ken Kesey or Tim Leary, was the original LSD pioneer. He also was a lifelong U.S. intelligence agent and a very, very mysterious character. We're going to take a look at the ubiquitous role of the CIA in the spreading of the LSD doctrine, so to speak, to leading American intellectuals, whether we're looking at the aforementioned Tim Leary or Ken Kesey, whether we're looking at Aldous Huxley, whether we're looking at Allen Ginsberg. In the background of each of these key LSD proselytizers' introduction to that drug, we find the Central Intelligence Agency and people who were pivotally involved in the CIA's efforts testing efforts. LSD research was virtually unknown in this country until the CIA, through a number of domestic funding conduits, began pumping millions of dollars into research with this drug. We're going to take a look at the CIA's role in the Summer of Love, the 20th anniversary of which is about to be to break upon us here in the Bay Area, with a lot of, and this is my editorial comment, revolting commemorations of that phenomenon. And it should be said, too, that the book that we're going to rely on for a lot of our broadcast this evening, although it has a lot of excellent information, does wax, I find, nauseatingly maudlin with regard to the psychedelic era, quote-unquote. The book sort of splits between devastating and insightful analysis and a lot of essentially nostalgic and I think fairly useless rumination and reminiscing about the glories of the psychedelic era. Whatever one, what conclusion one comes to about just what the CIA and other intelligence agencies were up to with regard to the use of LSD. Again, for the purposes of brevity, the thesis of the entire broadcast this evening is basically that the CIA is totally inseparable from the LSD phenomenon in America, whether we look at LSD as a research tool, as it was initially, or whether we look at it as the underground recreational drug of choice that it became in the 1960s. Throughout the growth and spread of the LSD phenomenon, the CIA is there, and again, are completely inseparable from it. At the end of the broadcast this evening, we're going to speculate to a certain extent about some of the things that they may have had in mind with their efforts.
That's right. Not only for you you ex-hippies out there, not only is 1987 the 20th anniversary of the, quote, Summer of Love, unquote, it's also the 40th anniversary of the formation of the CIA. And for those of you out there who are not previously familiar with the overlap that Dave mentioned between those two phenomena, you will be probably rather interested to stay tuned with us for tonight's broadcast. I just also wanted to mention that the book that we're going to be using heavily, not exclusively, but almost exclusively tonight, as Dave mentioned, is a book called Acid Dreams, subtitled The CIA, LSD, and the 60s Rebellion. The book is written by Martin A. Lee and Bruce Schlain, S-H-L-A-I-N, copyright 1985 by Grove Press, New York, and it is certainly worth your while. It is out right now. It is available, I think, in a lot of bookstores. It is probably also available in your local libraries and a variety of other places, and we are going to be covering a lot of it tonight, but obviously we cannot read the entire book to you, and it wouldn't hurt at all to go out and buy a copy and support researchers doing this kind of work. So, again, that small commercial over. Acid Dreams is the book we're going to be quoting from heavily tonight.
Okay, and again, we're going to begin by taking a look at the history of the CIA's research into LSD and the military's research into LSD, and observe the manner in which their interest in acid, which grew out of a number of different CIA mind control programs, part of which focused on the search for truth serum. Basically, this is where LSD got its start in American society. It was, as we're going to read here very shortly, virtually an unknown phenomenon. There was almost no one doing LSD research in the United States until the CIA began pumping a lot of capital into that type of research. All of a sudden, there were a lot of people doing that research. Very quickly, the drug spread from the laboratory to the street, and we will be analyzing the possible role of the CIA in effecting that switch deliberately.
Indeed, and as the as Dave made the point, it's very important to realize that a lot of the direct information that initially went into the CIA's mind control, interrogation, and later behavioral control investigations came directly out of the records of people like Dr. Hubertus Strughold in Dachau, and Strughold, who of course then later was brought into the United States and feted with all sorts of honors and called father of the space program, along with Wernher von Braun and Walter K. Dornberger, a couple of other real princes who, among other things, in the prison camp that served as their workshop, used to string people up on wires as an example to other prisoners. But Strughold used to do things like injecting people with gasoline, shooting them to see how quickly the wounds would congeal under certain types of conditions, freezing them to death in ice cold water, and all kinds of stuff. This is one of the fathers of our space program. With this as an example, and these people being regarded as useful and worthwhile influences for the CIA to bring into the United States, it's very little surprise that a little later on in the program that the CIA wouldn't find any ethical problems with jamming an ice pick into somebody's brain because they were a security problem. Again, an innocent human volunteer, not a Soviet spy.
This is by way of showing not only the early progress of the mind control programs of the CIA, which gave direct rise to the LSD phenomenon in the United States, but by way of showing the moral and historical background to the LSD phenomenon. As we will repeat later in the broadcast, if this is your idea of peace and love, I'd hate to see your idea of hate and war.
Continuing with Acid Dreams, it's from a section labeled Enter LSD. It was with the hope of finding the long-sought miracle drug that CIA investigators first began to dabble with LSD-25 in the early 1950s. At the time, very little was known about the hallucinogen, even in scientific circles. Dr. Wernher Stoll, the son of Sandoz president Arthur Stoll and a colleague of Albert Hofmann's, was the first person to investigate the psychological properties of LSD. The results of his study were presented in the Swiss Archives of Neurology in 1947. Stoll reported that LSD produced disturbances in perception, hallucinations, and acceleration in thinking. Moreover, the drug was found to blunt the usual suspiciousness of schizophrenic patients. No unfavorable after effects were described. 2 years later, in the same journal, Stoll contributed a second report entitled, quote, "A New Hallucinatory Agent Active in Very Small Amounts," unquote. The fact that LSD caused hallucinations should not have been a total surprise to the scientific community. Sandoz first became interested in ergot, E-R-G-O-T, the natural source of lysergic acid, because of numerous stories passed down through the ages. The rye fungus had a mysterious, it's rye, R-Y-E, not W-R-Y, they're not anthropomorphizing it. The rye fungus had a mysterious and contradictory reputation. In China and parts of the Mideast, it was thought to possess medicinal qualities, and certain scholars believe that it may have been used in sacred rites in ancient Greece. In other parts of Europe, however, the same fungus was associated with a horrible malady known as St. Anthony's Fire, which struck periodically like the plague. Medieval chronicles tell of villages and towns where nearly everyone went mad for a few days after ergot-diseased rye was unknowingly milled into flour and baked as bread. Men were afflicted with gangrenous limbs that looked like blackened stumps, and pregnant women miscarried. Even in modern times, there have been reports of ergot-related epidemics. The CIA inherited this ambiguous legacy when it embraced LSD as a mind-controlled drug. An artichoke document, Operation Artichoke, by the way, was another CIA mind-control program coming out of Operation Bluebird. An artichoke document, dated October 21st, 1951, indicates that acid was tested initially as part of a pilot study of the effects of various chemicals, quote, "on the conscious suppression of experimental or non-threat secrets." In addition to lysergic acid, this particular survey covered a wide range of substances, including morphine, ether, benzedrine, ethyl alcohol, and mescaline. Quote, "There is no question," noted the author of this report, "that drugs are already on hand, and new ones are being produced, that can destroy integrity and make indiscreet the most dependable individual." The report concluded by recommending that LSD be critically tested, quote, "under threat conditions beyond the scope of civilian experimentation," unquote. POWs, federal prisoners, and security officers were mentioned as possible candidates for these field experiments. In another study, designed to ascertain optimal dosage levels for interrogation sessions, a CIA psychiatrist administered LSD to, quote, "at least 12 human subjects of not too high mentality," unquote. At the outset, the subjects were, quote, "told only that a new drug was being tested and promised that nothing serious or dangerous would happen to them. During the intoxication, they realized something was happening, but were never told exactly what," unquote. A dosage range of 100 to 150 micrograms was finally selected, and the agency proceeded to test the drug in mock interrogation trials. Initial reports seemed promising. In one instance, LSD was given to an officer who had been instructed not to reveal, quote, "a significant military secret." When questioned, however, quote, "he gave all the details of the secret, and after the effects of the LSD had worn off, the officer had no knowledge of revealing the information. Complete amnesia," unquote. Favorable reports kept coming in, and when this phase of experimentation was completed, the CIA's Office of Scientific Intelligence, OSI, prepared a lengthy memorandum entitled "Potential New Agent for Unconventional Warfare." LSD was said to be useful, quote, "for eliciting true and accurate statements from subjects under its influence during interrogation," unquote. Moreover, the data on hand suggested that LSD might help in reviving memories of past experiences.
Now, the next section of acid dreams that we're going to look at underscores the manner in which it was the very research, which we now see being in our historical retrospective here, which we see being undertaken in the early 1950s under the auspices of Operation Artichoke, that it was the push to develop this mind control and ostensibly, at least, or initially, truth serum drug, which was what the CIA was looking for with LSD. This is what brought the LSD research into our society. Initially, there was almost no one doing LSD research, and the very research programs that we're talking about here was what brought LSD into American society. Again, hardly anybody was doing anything one way or the other with LSD as a result of the CIA's programs to test this drug as a possible truth serum, mind control drug, and what have you. LSD became a major, major asset to Americans, not asset, but a major adjunct to American psychological research. We're going to take a look at that now, the experimentation programs undertaken on human subjects, and the manner in which, literally, LSD came from the CIA. Returning to acid dreams. When the CIA first became interested in LSD, only a handful of scientists in the United States were engaged in hallucinogenic drug research. At the time, there was little private or public support for this relatively new field of experimental psychiatry, and no one had undertaken a systematic investigation of LSD. The CIA's mind control specialists sensed a golden opportunity in the making. With a sizable treasure chest at their disposal, they were in a position to boost the careers of scientists whose skill and expertise would be of maximum benefit to the CIA. Almost overnight, a whole new market for grants and LSD research sprang into existence as money started pouring through CIA-linked conduits or cutouts, such as the Geschichter Fund for Medical Research, the Society for the Study of Human Ecology, and the Josiah Macy Jr. Foundation. Among those who benefited from the CIA's largesse was Dr. Max Rinkel, R-I-N-K-E-L, the first person to bring LSD to the United States. In 1949, Rinkel, a research psychiatrist, obtained a supply of LSD from Sandoz Pharmaceuticals in Switzerland and gave the drug to his partner, Dr. Robert Hyde, who took the first acid trip in the Western Hemisphere. Rinkel and Hyde went on to organize an LSD study at the Boston Psychopathic Institute, a pioneering mental health clinic affiliated with Harvard University. They tested the drug on 100 volunteers and reported the initial findings in May of 1950, nearly 3 years before the CIA began funding their work, at the annual meeting of the American Psychiatric Association. Rinkel announced that LSD produced, quote, a transitory psychotic disturbance, unquote, in normal subjects. This was highly significant, for it raised the possibility that mental disorders could be studied objectively in a controlled experimental setting. Rinkel's hypothesis was supported and expanded upon during the same forum by Dr. Paul Hoch, or Hoch, H-O-C-H, a prominent psychiatrist who would also proffer his services to the CIA in the years ahead. Hoch reported that the symptoms produced by LSD, mescaline, and related drugs were similar to those of schizophrenia. Intensity of color perception, hallucinations, depersonalization, intense anxiety, paranoia, and in some cases, catatonic manifestations. As Hoch put it, quote, LSD and mescaline disorganize the psychic integration of the individual, unquote. He believed that the medical profession was fortunate to have access to these substances, for now it would be possible to reconstruct temporary or model psychoses in the laboratory. LSD was considered an exceptional research tool in that the subject could provide a detailed description of his experience while he was under the influence of the drug. It was hoped that careful analysis of these data would shed new light on schizophrenia and other enigmatic mental diseases. Hoch's landmark thesis, that LSD was a psychotomimetic or madness-mimicking agent, caused a sensation in scientific circles and led to several important and stimulating theories regarding the biochemical basis of schizophrenia. This, in turn, sparked an upsurge of interest in brain chemistry and opened new vistas in the field of experimental psychiatry. In light of the extremely high potency of LSD, it seemed completely plausible that infinitesimal traces of a psychoactive substance produced through metabolic dysfunction by the human organism might cause psychotic disturbances. Conversely, attempts to alleviate a lysergic psychosis, unquote, might point the way toward curing schizophrenia and other forms of mental illness. As it turned out, the model psychosis concept dovetailed particularly well with the secret schemes of the CIA, which also viewed LSD in terms of its ability to blow minds and make people crazy. Thus, it is not surprising that the CIA chose to invest in men like Rinkel and Hoch. Most scientists were flattered by the government's interest in their research, and they were eager to assist the CIA in its attempts to unravel the riddle of LSD. This was, after all, the Cold War, and one did not have to be a blue-ribbon hawk or a hardliner to work in tandem with American intelligence. In the early 1950s, the CIA approached Dr. Nick Bercel, B-E-R-C-E-L, a psychiatrist who maintained a private practice in Los Angeles. Bercel was one of the first people in the United States to work with LSD, and the CIA asked him to consider a haunting proposition. What would happen if the Russians put LSD in the water supply of a large American city? A skillful saboteur could carry enough acid in his coat pocket to turn an entire metropolis into a loony bin, assuming he found a way to distribute it equally. In light of this frightening prospect, would Brussel render a patriotic service by calculating exactly how much LSD would be required to contaminate the water supply of Los Angeles? Brussel consented, and that evening he dissolved a tiny amount of acid in a glass of tap water, only to discover that the chlorine neutralized the drug. "Don't worry," he told his CIA contact, "it won't work." Remember this scenario of dosing American reservoirs later. We're going to come in contact with an interesting proposition by Timothy Leary in that regard.
Another interesting proposition right here is the fact that the CIA presented it apparently to Dr. Brussel as being something they were worried that a Soviet saboteur might do, and when he told them it wouldn't work, well, we'll see. Continuing, the agency took this as a mandate, and another version of LSD was eventually concocted to overcome this drawback. A CIA document states accordingly, quote, "If the concept of contaminating a city's water supply seems, or in actual fact, is found to be far-fetched, this is by no means certain, there is still the possibility of contaminating, say, the water supply of a bomber base, or, more easily still, that of a battleship. Our current work contains the strong suggestion that LSD-25 will produce hysteria, unaccountable laughing, anxiety, terror. It requires little imagination to realize what the consequences might be if a battleship's crew were so affected," unquote. The CIA never got in touch with Brussel again, but they monitored his research reports in various medical journals. When Brussel gave LSD to spiders, they spun perfectly symmetrical webs. Animal studies also showed that cats cringed before untreated mice, and fish that normally swam close to the bottom of a water tank hovered near the top. In another experiment, Dr. Louis Jolyon Jolly West, chairman of the Department of Psychiatry at the University of Oklahoma, injected an elephant with a massive dose of 300,000 micrograms. Dr. West, a CIA contract employee and an avid believer in the notion that hallucinogens were psychotomimetic agents, was trying to duplicate the periodic, quote, rut madness that overtakes male elephants for about 1 week each year. But the animal did not experience a model elephant psychosis. It just keeled over and remained in a motionless stupor. In attempting to revive the elephant, West administered a combination of drugs that ended up killing the poor beast. Research on human subjects showed that LSD lodged primarily in the liver, spleen, and kidneys. Only a tiny amount, 0.01%, of the original dose entered the brain, and it only remained there for 20 minutes. This was a most curious finding, as the effect of LSD was not evident until the drug had disappeared entirely from the central nervous system. Some scientists thought that LSD might act as a trigger mechanism, releasing or inhibiting a naturally occurring substance in the brain, but no one could figure out exactly why the drug had such a dramatic effect on the mind. Many other questions were in need of clarification. Could the drug be fatal? Well, parenthetically, obviously it could to elephants anyway. What was the maximum dose? Were the effects constant, or were there variations according to different personality types? Could the reaction be accentuated by combining LSD with other chemicals? Was there an antidote? Some of these questions overlapped with legitimate medical concerns, and researchers on CIA stipends published unclassified versions of their work in prestigious scientific periodicals. But these accounts omitted secret data given to the CIA on how LSD affected, quote, operationally pertinent categories, such as disturbance of memory, alteration of sex patterns, eliciting information, increasing suggestibility, and creating emotional dependence.
Continuing.
We actually, if we're going to try and get a 45-minute break for people to flip tapes, we should probably do it now.
Oh, okay. Why don't we read one more section here,
okay,
and then we'll give them a chance to. Continuing with acid dreams. The CIA was particularly interested in psychiatric reports suggesting that LSD could break down familiar behavior patterns, for this raised the possibility of reprogramming or brainwashing. If LSD temporarily altered a person's view of the world and suspended his belief system, CIA doctors surmised, then perhaps Russian spies could be cajoled into switching loyalties while they were tripping. This brainwashing strategy was relatively simple. Find the subject's weakest point, his squeaky board, unquote, and bear down on it. Use any combination or synthesis which might, quote, open the mind to the power of suggestion to a degree never hitherto dreamed possible, unquote. LSD would be employed to provoke a reality shift, to break someone down and tame him, to find a locus of anonymity and leave a mark there forever. To explore the feasibility of this approach, the agency turned to Dr. Ewan Cameron, C-A-M-E-R-O-N, a respected psychiatrist who served as president of the Canadian, the American, and the World Psychiatric Associations before his death in 1967. Cameron also directed the Alain Memorial Institute at Montreal's McGill University, where he developed a bizarre and unorthodox method for treating schizophrenia. With financial backing from the CIA, he tested his method on 53 patients at Alain, or Alain, A-L-L-A-I-N. The so-called treatment started with sleep therapy, unquote, in which subjects were knocked out for months at a time. The next phase, depatterning, entailed massive electroshock and frequent doses of LSD designed to wipe out past behavior patterns. Then Cameron tried to recondition the mind through a technique known as psychic driving, unquote. The patients, once again heavily sedated, were confined to sleep rooms, unquote, where tape-recorded messages played over and over from speakers under their pillows. Some heard the same message a quarter of a million times. Cameron's methods were later discredited, and the CIA grudgingly gave up the notion of LSD as a brainwashing technique. But that was little consolation to those who served as guinea pigs for the CIA's secret mind control projects. 9 of Cameron's former patients have sued the American government for $1 million each, claiming that they are still suffering from the trauma they went through at Alain. These people never agreed to participate in a scientific experiment, a fact which reflects little credit on the CIA, even if agency officials feared that the Soviets were spurting ahead in the mind control race. The CIA violated the Nuremberg Code for Medical Ethics by sponsoring experiments on unwitting subjects. Ironically, Dr. Cameron was a member of the Nuremberg Tribunal that heard the case against Nazi war criminals who committed atrocities during World War II. Like the Nazi doctors at Dachau, the CIA victimized certain groups of people who were unable to resist: prisoners, mental patients, foreigners, the terminally ill, sexual deviants, and ethnic minorities. One project took place at the Addiction Research Center of the U.S. Public Health Service Hospital in Lexington, Kentucky. Lexington was ostensibly a place where heroin addicts could go to shake a habit, and although it was officially a penitentiary, all the inmates were referred to as patients. The patients had their own way of referring to the doctors, hacks, or croakers, unquote, who patrolled the premises in military uniforms. The patients at Lexington had no way of knowing that it was one of 15 penal and mental institutions utilized by the CIA in its super-secret drug development program. To conceal its role, the agency enlisted the aid of the Navy and the National Institutes of Mental Health, which served as conduits for channeling money to Dr. Harris Isbell, I-S-B-E-L-L, a gung-ho research scientist who remained on the CIA payroll for over a decade. According to CIA documents, the directors of NIMH and the National Institutes of Health were fully cognizant of the agency's interest in Isbell's work and offered full support and protection, unquote. When the CIA came across a new drug, usually supplied by American pharmaceutical firms that needed testing, they frequently sent it over to their chief doctor at Lexington, where an ample supply of captive guinea pigs was readily available. Over 800 compounds were farmed out to Isbell, including LSD and a variety of hallucinogens. It became an open secret among street junkies that if the supply got tight, you could always commit yourself to Lexington, where heroin and morphine were doled out as payment if you volunteered for Isbell's wacky drug experiments. Small wonder that Lexington had a return rate of 90%. Dr. Isbell, a longtime member of the Food and Drug Administration's Advisory Committee on the Abuse of Depressant and Stimulant Drugs, defended the volunteer system on the grounds that there was no precedent at the time for offering inmates cash for their services.
Okay, when we come back from a short break, we are going to be reading a little bit more about Dr. Isbell's CIA-funded and assisted experiments, and we're going to be talking more about the formation of the CIA's concept of LSD as a behavior control substance, even more than an interrogation technique.
For people who eventually hear this program via a rebroadcast, or for people who listen to it on tape, that will continue on the second side of this particular cassette series.
We're reading and we're talking at this moment about the CIA-subsidized experiments of a gentleman by the name of Dr. Isbell, I-S-B-E-L-L.
Recall now, he was administering LSD under all kinds of strange conditions to inmates, people who were trying to get themselves cured of drug addiction, as a matter of fact, that it basically what amounted almost to an outpatient treatment center in Lexington, Massachusetts.
Kentucky.
Lexington, Kentucky, rather. These were people that were trying to get off drugs, and so Dr. Isbell with his CIA financed research was doing was administering large quantities of LSD to them. The irony of that, I don't think, needs to be underscored any
further.
And then
paying them off with heroin and morphine for going through the LSD experience. So,
well, just as long as he was fair.
Yeah, a real prince. Anyway, we're going to go on. We're going to continue with Acid Dreams, talking about the experiments and we'll let it speak for itself. CIA documents describe experiments conducted by Isbell. This, of course, Dr. Harris Isbell, Lexington, Kentucky, in which certain patients, nearly all black inmates, were given LSD for more than 75 consecutive days. In order to overcome tolerance to the hallucinogen, Isbell administered, quote, double, triple, and quadruple doses. A report dated May 5, 1959, comments on experiments involving psilocybin, a semi-synthetic version of the magic mushroom. Subjects who ingested the drug became extremely anxious, although sometimes there were periods of intense elation marked by, quote, continuous gales of laughter. A few patients felt that, quote, they had become very large or had shrunk to the size of children. Their hands or feet did not seem to be their own and sometimes took on the appearance of animal paws. They reported many fantasies or dreamlike states in which they seemed to be elsewhere. Fantastic experiences, such as trips to the moon or living in gorgeous castles, were occasionally reported, unquote. Isbell concluded, quote, despite these striking subjective experiences, the patients remained oriented in time, place, and person. In most instances, the patients did not lose their insight, but realized that the effects were due to the drug. Two of the nine patients, however, did lose insight and felt that their experiences were caused by the experimenters controlling their minds, unquote. In addition to his role as a research scientist, Dr. Isbell served as a go-between for the CIA in its attempts to obtain drug samples from European pharmaceutical concerns, which assumed they were providing medicine to a U.S. public health official. The CIA, in turn, acted as a research coordinator, passing information, tips, and leads to Isbell and its other contract employees so that they could keep abreast of each other's progress. When a new discovery was made, the CIA would often ask another researcher to conduct a follow-up study for confirmation. One scientist whose work was coordinated with Isbell's in such a manner was Dr. Carl Pfeiffer, P-F-E-I-F-F-E-R, a noted pharmacologist from Princeton who tested LSD on inmates at the federal prison in Atlanta and the Bordentown Reformatory in New Jersey. Isbell, Pfeiffer, Cameron, West, and Hoke all were part of a network of doctors and scientists who gathered intelligence for the CIA. Through these scholar informants, the agency stayed on top of the latest developments within the, quote, above-ground LSD scene, which expanded rapidly during the Cold War.
Now, as indicated in the first section of the broadcast, the use of LSD by American psychological research organizations and individuals was spurred by this CIA domestic funding. Now, we're going to look at the next major stage of the CIA's LSD testing, in which not only were people tested without being told precisely what was going to be done to them, but people were tested in an outside or street contexts. In other words, no longer was this being done inside of mental and penal institutions. This was being done out on the streets of America, and it's at this point, and we're going to take a look at this street testing, so to speak, again, of unwitting human subjects, this under the CIA's MKUltra program. It was in the course of the MKUltra program that eventually the LSD spread to the society as a whole. Continuing with Acid Dreams. In a speech before the National Alumni Conference at Princeton University on April 10, 1953, newly appointed CIA Director Alan Dulles lectured his audience on, quote, how the sinister battle for men's minds had become in Soviet hands, unquote. The human mind, Dulles warned, was a malleable tool, and the Red Menace had secretly developed brain perversion techniques. Some of these methods were so subtle and so abhorrent to our way of life that we have recoiled from facing up to them. Dulles continued, the minds of selected individuals who are subjected to such treatment are deprived of the ability to state their own thoughts. Parrot-like, the individuals so conditioned can merely repeat the thoughts which have been implanted in their minds by suggestions from outside. In effect, the brain becomes a phonograph, playing a disc put on its spindle by an outside genius over which it has no control, unquote. 3 days after delivering this address, Dulles authorized Operation MKUltra, the CIA's major drug and mind control program during the Cold War. MKUltra was the brainchild of Richard Helms, a high-ranking member of the clandestine services, otherwise known as the Dirty Tricks Department, who championed such methods throughout his career as an intelligence officer. As Helms explained to Dulles when he first proposed the MKUltra project, aside from the offensive potential, the development of a comprehensive capability in this field gives us a thorough knowledge of the enemy's theoretical potential, thus enabling us to defend ourselves against a foe who might not be as restrained in the use of these techniques as we are, unquote. The super-secret MKUltra program was run by a relatively small unit within the CIA known as the Technical Services Staff, or TSS. Originally established as a supplementary funding mechanism to the Artichoke Project, MKUltra quickly grew into a mammoth undertaking that outflanked earlier mind control initiatives.
And those of you who are prone to a black sense of humor will have to probably refrain from some dark chuckles over Alan Dulles talking about the brain perversion techniques and the sinister Soviets while the CIA was jamming ice picks into people's brains to keep them from talking about the experiments that had been done to them. Continuing in acid dreams. Incidents such as this...
Oh, by the way, the authors are talking about human experimentation on subjects.
Yes, this is a CIA operative himself who had a very, very bad experience on LSD. Incidents such as these reaffirmed to the MKUltra crew just how devastating a weapon LSD could be. But this only made them more enthusiastic about the drug. They kept springing it on people in a manner reminiscent of the ritual hazing of fraternity pledges. Quote, "It was just too damned informal," a TSS officer later said. "We didn't know much. We were playing around in ignorance. We were just naive about what we were doing." Such pranks claimed their first victim in November 1953, when a group of CIA and Army technicians gathered for a three-day work retreat at a remote hunting lodge in the backwoods of Maryland. On the second day of the meeting, Dr. Gottlieb spiked the after-dinner cocktails with LSD. As the drug began to take effect, Gottlieb told everyone that they had ingested a mind-altering chemical. By that time, the group had become boisterous with laughter and unable to carry on a coherent conversation. One man was not amused by the unexpected turn of events. Dr. Frank Olson, an Army scientist who specialized in biological warfare research, had never taken LSD before, and he slid into a deep depression. His mood did not lighten when the conference adjourned. Normally a gregarious family man, Olson returned home quiet and withdrawn. When he went to work after the weekend, he asked his boss to fire him because he had, quote, messed up the experiment during the retreat. Alarmed by his erratic behavior, Olson's superiors contacted the CIA, which sent him to New York to see Dr. Harold Abramson. A respected physician, Abramson taught at Columbia University and was chief of the allergy clinic at Mount Sinai Hospital. He was also one of the CIA's principal LSD researchers and a part-time consultant to the Army Chemical Corps. While these were impressive credentials, Abramson was not a trained psychiatrist, and it was this kind of counseling his patient desperately needed. For the next few weeks, Olson confided his deepest fears to Abramson. He claimed the CIA was putting something in his coffee to make him stay awake at night. He said people were plotting against him, and he heard voices at odd hours commanding him to throw away his wallet, which he did, even though it contained several uncashed checks. Dr. Abramson concluded that Olson was mired in, quote, a psychotic state with delusions of persecution that had been, quote, crystallized by the LSD experience. Arrangements were made to move him to Chestnut Lodge, a sanatorium in Rockville, Maryland, staffed by CIA-cleared psychiatrists. Apparently, other CIA personnel who suffered from psychiatric disorders were enrolled in this institution. On his last evening in New York, Olson checked into a room at the Statler Hilton along with a CIA agent assigned to watch him. And then, in the wee hours of the morning, the troubled scientist plunged headlong through a closed window to his death 10 floors below.
Continuing with acid dreams, the Olson suicide had immediate repercussions within the CIA. An elaborate cover-up erased clues to the actual circumstances leading up to his death. Olson's widow was eventually given a government pension, and the full truth of what happened would not be revealed for another 20 years. Meanwhile, CIA Director Alan Dulles suspended the in-house testing program for a brief period while an internal investigation was conducted. In the end, Gottlieb and his team received only a mildly worded reprimand for exercising bad judgment, unquote, but no records of the incident were kept in their personnel files, which would harm their future careers. The importance of LSD eclipsed all other considerations, and the secret acid tests resumed. Gottlieb was now ready to undertake the final and most daring phase of the MKUltra program. LSD would be given to unwitting targets in real-life situations. But who would actually do the dirty work? While looking through some old OSS files, Gottlieb discovered that marijuana had been tested on unsuspecting subjects in an effort to develop a truth serum. These experiments had been organized by George Hunter White, a tough, old-fashioned narcotics officer who ran a training school for American spies during World War II. Perhaps White would be interested in testing drugs for the CIA. As a matter of protocol, Gottlieb first approached Harry Anslinger, chief of the Federal Narcotics Bureau. Anslinger was favorably disposed and agreed to lend, unquote, one of his top men to the CIA on a part-time basis. Right from the start, White had plenty of leeway in running his operations. He rented an apartment in New York's Greenwich Village, and with funds supplied by the CIA, he transformed it into a safe house complete with two-way mirrors, surveillance equipment, and the like. Posing as an artist and a seaman, White lured people back to his pad and slipped them drugs. A clue as to how his subjects fared can be found in White's personal diary, which contains passing references to surprise LSD experiments. Quote, Gloria gets horrors, Janet sky high, unquote. The frequency of bad reactions prompted White to coin his own word for the drug, stormy, which was how he referred to LSD throughout his 14-year stint as a CIA operative. In 1955, White was transferred to San Francisco, where two more safe houses were established. During this period, he initiated Operation Midnight Climax, in which drug-addicted prostitutes were hired to pick men up from local bars and bring them back to a CIA-financed bordello. Unknowing customers were treated to drinks laced with LSD while White sat on a portable toilet behind a two-way mirror, sipping martinis and watching every stoned and kinky moment. As payment for their services, the hookers received $100 a night, plus a guarantee from White that he'd intercede on their behalf should they be arrested while plying their trade. In addition to providing data about LSD, Midnight Climax enabled the CIA to learn about the sexual proclivities of those who passed through the safe houses. White's harem of prostitutes became the focal point of an extensive CIA study of how to exploit the art of lovemaking for espionage purposes. So again, under the MKUltra program, the LSD testing by the CIA moves from penal and mental institutions to street situations. And as we're going to take a look now, as we begin looking at what the authors Lee and Schlein refer to as psychedelic pioneers, in other words, the LSD proselytizers, people who were responsible for the growing cultural popularity of LSD, we're going to find, as we, so to speak, swing the camera away from some of the main figures involved in LSD proselytization, and we're going to find many of the same people involved in the CIA's mind control programs, and specifically in the LSD testing on various human subjects. Well, as I say, when we turn the camera away from these psychedelic proselytizers, we always find the key figures in the CIA's programs just off camera, I guess you could say, just waiting in the wings.
All right, now we're going to talk about, as Dave put, one of these psychedelic pioneers, as Lee and Schlein term him. They also call him the original Captain Trips.
This is, although most people usually associate names like Tim Leary and Ken Kesey, both of whom we're going to talk about, the original LSD proselytizer was a man named Captain Alfred M. Hubbard, and where the Captain moniker comes from, we will find out right now.
The stout, crew-cut figure riding in the Rolls-Royce was a mystery to those who knew him. A spy by profession, he lived a life of intrigue and adventure befitting his chosen career. Born dirt poor in Kentucky, he served with the OSS during the Second World War and went on to make a fortune as a uranium entrepreneur. His prestigious government and business connections read like a who's who of the power elite in North America. His name was Captain Alfred M. Hubbard. His friends called him Cappy, and he was known as the Johnny Appleseed of LSD. The blustery, rum-drinking Hubbard is widely credited with being the first person to emphasize LSD's potential as a visionary or transcendental drug. His faith in the LSD revelation was such that he made it his life's mission to turn on as many men and women as possible. Quote, "Most people are walking in their sleep," he said. turn them around, start them in the opposite direction, and they wouldn't even know the difference. But there was a quick way to remedy that. Give them a good dose of LSD and, quote, let them see themselves for what they are. That Hubbard, of all people, should have emerged as the first genuine LSD apostle is all the more curious in light of his long-standing affiliation with the cloak and dagger trade. Indeed, he was no run-of-the-mill spook. As a high-level OSS officer, the captain directed an extremely sensitive covert operation that involved smuggling weapons and war material to Great Britain prior to the attack on Pearl Harbor. In pitch darkness, he sailed ships without lights up the coast of Vancouver, where they were refitted and used as destroyers by the British Navy. He also flew planes to the border, took them apart, towed the pieces into Canada, and sent them to England. These activities began with the quiet approval of President Roosevelt nearly a year and a half before the U.S. officially entered the war. To get around the neutrality snag, Hubbard became a Canadian citizen in a mock procedure. While based in Vancouver, where he later settled, he personally handled several $1 million filtered by the OSS through the American consulate to finance a multitude of covert operations in Europe. All this, of course, was highly illegal, and President Truman later issued a special pardon with kudos to the captain and his men. Not long after receiving this presidential commendation, Hubbard was introduced to LSD by Dr. Ronald Sandison of Great Britain. During his first acid trip in 1951, he claimed to have witnessed his own conception. Quote, "It was the deepest mystical thing I've ever seen," the captain recounted. "I saw myself as a tiny mite in a big swamp with a spark of intelligence. I saw my mother and father having intercourse. It was all clear."
Before we go on to analyze Hubbard's role in becoming the, quote, Johnny Appleseed of LSD, some more information about his background, continuing with acid dreams. After his legendary exploits with the OSS, the captain continued to serve as an undercover operative for various agencies within the U.S. government. He had many contacts with the FBI, for example, and he claimed to be a close friend of J. Edgar Hoover's. "That old bugger was tough, really tough," Hubbard said with admiration, "but when he tried to turn on the FBI chief, Hoover stubbornly declined. However, the captain did manage to give the drug, quote, to some top intelligence men in Washington, always with good results," unquote. During the early 1950s, Hubbard was asked to join the CIA, but he refused. "They lied so much, cheated so much, I don't like them," he snarled. "They're lousy deceivers, sons of the devils themselves," unquote. The captain's beef with the agency stemmed in part from his unsuccessful attempt to secure back pay owed to him from his OSS days. "They crooked me," he complained bitterly. As to whether or not his denials of working for CIA are to be taken at face value, listen to the following information. Hubbard was unkindly disposed toward the CIA for other reasons as well. Most important, he didn't approve of what the agency was doing with his beloved LSD. "The CIA work stinks," he said. "They were misusing it. I tried to tell them how to use it, but even when they were killing people, you couldn't tell them a goddamn thing." Hubbard was certain that Frank Olson was not the only person who died as a result of the CIA's surprise acid tests. "I don't know how Al's Washington affairs were done," Dr. Osmond admitted. That's Dr. Humphrey Osmond, about whom we're going to read more in a second. He worked very closely with Al Hubbard. Resuming, "I don't know how Al's Washington affairs were done," Dr. Osmond admitted. "He was one of those naturally brilliant wheeler dealers. Indeed, Hubbard seemed to have a knack for popping up in the most unpredictable places. He worked for the Treasury Department as a young man during the Capone days, busting moonshiners and gangsters who were smuggling liquor into the U.S. from Canada. Apparently, he was able to ingratiate himself with both sides during Prohibition, as he subsequently became Deputy Chief of Security for the Tropicana Hotel in Las Vegas. Those Mafia men were always interesting to talk to," Hubbard remarked, "but they never smiled," unquote. The captain also engaged in undercover work for a number of other government agencies, including the Federal Narcotics Bureau and the Food and Drug Administration, at a time when both organizations were assisting the CIA's drug testing programs. During the mid-1960s, he was employed by Teledyne, a major defense subcontractor, as, quote, Director of Human Factors Research, unquote. In this capacity, Hubbard served as advisor and consultant to a combined Navy and NASA project that involved testing the effects of psychochemical agents on a newly designed helicopter avionics system, unquote. Teledyne worked closely with various government organizations, including the CIA, to apply these techniques to additional areas of military interest. While Hubbard was not a CIA operative per se, his particular area of expertise, hallucinogenic drugs, brought him into close contact with elements of the espionage community. The CIA must have known what he was up to, since Sandoz and the FDA kept the agency informed whenever anyone received shipments of LSD. The captain, of course, was one of their best customers, having purchased large amounts of the drug on different occasions. So, although as they indicated, it cannot be said that Al Hubbard was a CIA operative per se, he was a veteran, lifelong intelligence agent connected intimately with many different agencies of the U.S. National Security Establishment, and as we said, he was the Johnny Appleseed of LSD.
One of the interesting things about Cappy Hubbard, we're going to be reading a little bit more about him in a moment. One of the interesting things about Hubbard is that here is a man who claimed that LSD changed his entire life, that most people are walking through life in a daze, not understanding what's going on, and the thing that they need to do is to take LSD to change their perspective on things. Yet here's a man who took LSD in 1951 and still managed to work for all sorts of various government agencies involved in all kinds of military research and things of that nature. So as far as the common kind of cliche experience of people turning on to LSD and dropping out, it certainly didn't seem to affect Cappy Hubbard that way. He seemed, as a matter of fact, to continue even stronger, working for the government and for the defense establishment and working in various things having to do with human factors research, quote unquote.
Now we're going to take a look at Hubbard's work with a civilian researcher named Dr. Humphrey Osmond, and civilian perhaps should be taken in quotes because he too had strong connections to the CIA's LSD research, although it cannot be said how aware he was of the source of his funding. But the point is, Al Hubbard and Dr. Humphrey Osmond became two of the pioneers of, quote, LSD therapy, unquote, and they in turn turned on a person who was to become one of the major proselytizers of the so-called psychedelic era and one of the people whose literary work spurred a great many people to experiment with LSD and other hallucinogens, Aldous Huxley.
All right. Hubbard, then 49 years old, eagerly sought out others familiar with hallucinogenic drugs. He contacted Dr. Humphrey Osmond, a young British psychiatrist who was working with LSD and mescaline at Weyburn Hospital in Saskatchewan, Canada. Like most other researchers in the field, Osmond was primarily interested in psychosis and mental illness. In 1952, he shocked the medical world by drawing attention to the structural similarity between the mescaline and adrenaline molecules, implying that schizophrenia might be a form of self-intoxication caused by the body mistakenly producing its own hallucinogenic compounds. Osmond noted that mescaline enabled a normal person to see the world through the eyes of a schizophrenic, and he suggested that the drug be used as a tool for training doctors, nurses, and other hospital personnel to understand their patients from a more intimate perspective. Osmond's research attracted widespread attention within scientific circles. The CIA, ever intent on knowing the latest facts as early as possible, quickly sent informants to find out what was happening at Weyburn Hospital. Unbeknownst to Osmond and his cohorts, throughout the next decade, they were contacted on repeated occasions by agency personnel. Indeed, it was impossible for an LSD researcher not to rub shoulders with the espionage establishment, for the CIA was monitoring the entire scene. I'm going to read that again, and then we're going to read a footnote that goes with it. Unbeknownst to Osmond and his cohorts, throughout the next decade, they were contacted on repeated occasions by agency personnel. Indeed, it was impossible for an LSD researcher not to rub shoulders with the espionage establishment, for the CIA was monitoring the entire scene. Now, there's a footnote that goes with this, talking a little bit more about some of Osmond's subsequent involvement. Osmond left Canada in 1963 and joined a group of researchers at the Princeton Neuropsychiatric Institute. There, he worked closely with Dr. Bernard Aronson, whose studies in hypnosis and altered states of consciousness were funded by the CIA through the Society for the Study of Human Ecology. Osmond and Aronson later co-authored a popular anthology called Psychedelics. Unlike Aronson, who was unaware of the CIA's interest in his work, Dr. Carl Pfeiffer, another Princeton researcher, had close ties with the CIA. As one of Pfeiffer's associates put it, quote, "Princeton was crawling with agents. They came courting everyone. It was obvious. They would give us whatever we wanted. We realized we were being recruited, but at that time we were flattered that such a prestigious government agency was interested in us," unquote. A little too interested, perhaps, a number of scientists soon discovered that their mail was being opened and read by government agents.
And again, this is worth mentioning because Dr. Humphrey Osmond, along with Al Hubbard, the man he was working with here, became one of the people to strongly influence Aldous Huxley's turn in the direction of pro-psychedelic crusading.
All right, continuing back to the main body of the passage. Osmond's reports also caught the eye of Aldous Huxley, the eminent British novelist who for years had been preoccupied with the specter of drug-induced thought control. In 1931, Huxley wrote Brave New World, a futuristic vision of a totalitarian society in which the world controllers chemically coerced the population into loving its servitude. While Huxley grappled with the question of human freedom under pharmacological attack, he also recognized that certain drugs, particularly the hallucinogens, produced radical changes in consciousness that could have a profound and beneficial effect. Upon learning of Osmond's work, he decided to offer himself as a guinea pig. Huxley seemed like the perfect subject. A learned man steeped in many disciplines, he was also gifted with a writer's eloquence. Even if the drug confounded him, it would not tongue-tie him, for he was a glorious talker. But Osmond was still a bit apprehensive. Quote, I did not relish the possibility, however remote, of being the man who drove Aldous Huxley mad, he explained. His worries proved to be unfounded. In May 1953, less than a month after the CIA initiated Operation MK-Ultra, Huxley tried mescaline for the first time at his home in Hollywood Hills, California, under Osmond's supervision. Quote, it was, according to Huxley, without question the most extraordinary and significant experience this side of the beatific vision. Moreover, quote, it opens up a host of philosophical problems, throws intense light, and raises all manner of questions in the field of aesthetics, religion, theory of knowledge. Huxley described his mescaline adventure in the famous essay The Doors of Perception, which took its title from the works of William Blake, the 18th-century British poet and visionary artist. With this book, Huxley unabashedly declared himself a propagandist for hallucinogenic drugs, and for the first time, a large segment of the educated public became aware of the existence of these substances. Not surprisingly, the treatise created a storm in literary circles. Some hailed it as a major intellectual statement, others dismissed it as pure quackery. Few critics realized that the book would have such an enormous impact in years to come.
So again, Aldous Huxley, whose book, the aforementioned Doors of Perception, was one of the pivotal motivators, I guess you could say, in terms of inclining people towards recreational hallucinogen use in the 60s, it should be noted that his introduction to psychedelic drugs came via Dr. Humphrey Osmond, who worked with Dr. Bernard Aronson on some of the CIA's LSD projects. And in turn, Humphrey Osmond and Al Hubbard, the people who, quote, turned on, so to speak, Aldous Huxley, are two of the people, well, basically, Dr. Humphrey Osmond is heavily involved with Al Hubbard, who himself is an intelligence agent. And again, the point we're making here is that as we begin examining the cultural figures who were most responsible for the introduction of LSD into society as a recreational drug, when we move the camera off them, we find the CIA's LSD researchers and other intelligence people waiting in the wings. Of Aldous Huxley, the author of The Doors of Perception and some of his other intelligence connections, we will examine a couple of interesting footnotes here in Acid Dreams. Of Huxley, the authors Schlain and Lee write, in his letters, Huxley mentioned, my friend Dr. J. West, a reference to Jolly West, who conducted LSD studies for the CIA. At one point, while West was engaged in MK-Ultra research, Huxley suggested that he hypnotize his subjects prior to administering LSD in order to give them, quote, post-hypnotic suggestions aimed at orienting the drug-induced experience in some desired direction, unquote. Needless to say, the CIA was intrigued with this idea. Huxley also lectured on parapsychology at Duke University, where J.B. Rhine, R-H-I-N-E, with whom Huxley communicated, was engaged in ESP studies for the CIA and the Army. Well, Dr. Louis Joylon West, J-O-Y-L-O-N, was a person who we touched on briefly in the previous description of the CIA's early LSD research. He was the fellow who administered 300,000 micrograms to an elephant to see if he could simulate the rut madness, and then the elephant simply keeled over. Well, Louis Joylon West, friend of Aldous Huxley, key CIA LSD researcher, is an interesting fellow. In another footnote, Lee and Schlain write, West was head of the Department of Psychiatry at the University of Oklahoma during the 1950s and early 1960s when he conducted research into LSD, hypnosis, and, quote, the psychobiology of dissociated states, unquote, for the CIA. It was West who administered a massive dose of LSD to an elephant as part of an ill-fated drug experiment. In 1964, he was called upon to examine Jack Ruby, who had murdered Lee Harvey Oswald, the alleged assassin of President Kennedy. After visiting Ruby in his jail cell, West concluded that he had sunk into a, quote, paranoid state manifested by delusions, visual and auditory hallucinations, and suicidal impulses, unquote. Ruby was not faking these symptoms, West asserted, since he had vigorously rejected the doctor's repeated suggestions that he was mentally ill. Quote, the true malingerer usually grasps eagerly at such an explanation, said West. Since Ruby would not admit he was crazy, West concluded he was nuts. Catch 22. Ruby's delusions, unquote, included the belief that an ultra-right-wing conspiracy was behind the death of the president. On the basis of Dr. West's diagnosis, Ruby became a candidate for treatment of mental disorders. Another doctor soon put him on happy pills, unquote, although these drugs did not seem to cheer Ruby up. 2 years later, he died of cancer while still in prison. West, meanwhile, moved to Los Angeles, where he served as director of UCLA's Neuropsychiatric Institute, a position he still holds. In the early 1970s, he became embroiled in a heated controversy over plans for a center for the study and reduction of violence. Originally proposed by Governor Ronald Reagan, the violence center would have exceeded even Jack Ruby's worst paranoid nightmares had it not been scuttled by the California state legislature after information about it was leaked to the press. West, who helped formulate plans for the center, described the program as an attempt, quote, to predict the probability of occurrences, unquote, of violent behavior among specific population groups. The major known correlates of violence, according to West, are sex, male, age, youthful, ethnicity, black, and urbanicity, unquote. The violence center was to have been housed in a former military base located in a remote area of California. The medical facility at Vacaville Prison, the site of a major CIA drug testing program during the late 1960s and early 1970s, was listed among the facilities that would have been used to develop treatment models and implement pilot and demonstration programs for the violence center. Treatments discussed by West included chemical castration, psychosurgery, and the testing of experimental drugs on involuntarily incarcerated individuals. Furthermore, the activities of the center were to have been coordinated with a California law enforcement program that maintained computer files on pre-delinquent children so that they could be treated before they made a negative mark on society. Well, we've talked about a number of those different things in other archive shows. We talked about the UCLA study Center for the Study and Reduction of Violence in Radio Free America number 5, the first of our three-part series about mind control. We talked about Jack Ruby at great length in several of our Guns of November programs and others. Of course, his delusion that an ultra-right-wing conspiracy was behind the assassination of President Kennedy was about as delusional as the notion that the sun rises in the east and sets in the west. And it should be noted that at one point it was believed axiomatic that the sun revolved around the earth. The notion that Lee Harvey Oswald is a lone nut will hold about as much water as the geocentric theory of the solar system. The point is that Louis Jolyon West, a confidant, a colleague, and personal friend of Aldous Huxley, who in turn was turned on to LSD by Humphrey Osmond and Al Hubbard, Hubbard a lifelong intelligence agent, Humphrey Osmond one of the CIA's LSD researchers. It's worth noting the connections of Aldous Huxley, and this is not to indict the man in terms of an overall human being, but his LSD, his psychedelic proselytization, and his experiences with the drug are, again, inseparable from the intelligence community.
Continuing with another section of Acid Dreams, they're talking here about, of course, Allen Ginsberg, the poet, but they're talking specifically about the experience they talk about is a bad trip that Allen Ginsberg had. The trip itself, not so significant to it as how it came to be that Allen Ginsberg took the LSD in the first place. This became apparent to poet Allen Ginsberg when he took LSD for the first time at the Mental Research Institute in Palo Alto, California in 1959. Ginsberg was already familiar with psychedelic substances, having experimented with peyote on a number of occasions. As yet, however, there was no underground supply of LSD, and it was virtually impossible for lay folk to procure samples of the drug. Thus, he was pleased when Gregory Bateson, the anthropologist, put him in touch with a team of doctors in Palo Alto. Ginsburg had no way of knowing that one of the researchers associated with the Institute, Dr. Charles Savage, had conducted hallucinogenic drug experiments for the U.S. Navy in the early 1950s. And we're going to read the footnote on Gregory Bateson. Formerly a member, remember this is the, quote, anthropologist, formerly a member of the research and analysis branch of the OSS, Bateson was the husband and co-worker of anthropologist Margaret Mead. An exceptional intellect, he was turned on to acid by Dr. Harold Abramson, one of the CIA's chief LSD specialists. And Dr. Harold Abramson, of course, you heard that name already tonight because he was the man who was, quote, treating Frank Olson at the time that Frank Olson jumped out of a 10th-floor hotel window.
Right. So, again, with regard to Allen Ginsberg, and he was another of the major LSD proselytizers during the 1960s and 70s, again, his introduction to the drug, again, is inseparable from the intelligence community and the CIA's use of LSD on unwitting civilian subjects, and obviously some witting civilian subjects as well. Palo Alto, where Allen Ginsberg was introduced to LSD via people whose introduction came from the CIA, was also the place where Ken Kesey, another famous LSD proselytizer, was introduced to the drug. And he too was introduced to the drug via the U.S. National Security Establishment. Kesey's introduction to LSD is described by the authors as follows. Nearly a decade before, Kesey was introduced to psychedelics as part of a government-funded drug study in Palo Alto. Nearly a decade before Kesey was introduced to psychedelics as part of a government-funded drug study in Palo Alto, the CIA embarked upon a major effort to develop LSD into an effective mind-control weapon. The CIA's behavior modification programs were geared toward domestic as well as foreign populations. Targets included selected individuals and large groups of people. So again, the VA hospital through which Ken Kesey was introduced to LSD was as a result of a government-funded study, and the Defense Department, as elsewhere described by these authors, was central to that.
Okay, now they're talking, Lee and Schlein are now talking about a man whose name is very familiar to all of us, that of Timothy Leary. And Timothy Leary, they're talking about, first had his introduction, or first heard about, or was intrigued by the prospects of LSD by an article by a man by the name of R. Gordon Wasson, who was a vice president of J.P. Morgan and Company. A lifelong, interest in mushrooms led him to try psilocybin, to try the mushrooms themselves. Psilocybin is the synthetic version of same, and to write about his experiences. In Life magazine, among those whose interest was piqued by Wasson's article in Life was a young professor named Timothy Leary. At the time of Wasson's groundbreaking explorations, Leary was pursuing a successful career as a clinical psychologist. Between 1954 and 1959, he was director of clinical research and psychology at the Kaiser Foundation Hospital in Oakland, California. He published extensively in scientific journals and established himself as a rising star in the field of behavioral psychology. He wrote a widely acclaimed psychology textbook and devised a personality test called the Leary, which was used by the CIA, among other organizations, to test prospective employees.
More about Timothy Leary's research at Harvard with initially psilocybin and eventually LSD. Leary returned to Harvard and established a psilocybin research project with the approval of Dr. Harry Murray, chairman of the Department of Social Relations. Dr. Murray, who ran the personality assessment section of the OSS during World War II, took a keen interest in Leary's work. He volunteered for a psilocybin session, becoming one of the first of many faculty and graduate students to sample the mushroom pill under Leary's guidance. Leary had obtained a supply from Sandoz, which distributed the new drug to researchers free of charge. So it's interesting that the departmental chairman under whom Tim Leary initially began his research into hallucinogenic compounds was himself a key OSS veteran, because many of the veterans of the OSS, even after its dissolution, continued to maintain contact with the old boy intelligence networks. Although not formally agents, they continued to associate with and occasionally work with members of the intelligence community. Exactly how the exact nature of the relationship between Dr. Harry Murray and Tim Leary is something that I think future research needs to shed light on.
Now, they're going on to talk about the early days of Leary's LSD experience, which were at when he was at Harvard and were mostly in conjunction with two other educators there, Richard Alpert and Ralph Metzner, two of his associates, and there was a great deal of experimentation going on, a great deal of proselytization of the benefits of LSD as a sort of a purgative of the mind to get everybody out of their tired old ways of thinking. Not everyone was enchanted by the renegade psychedelic scene at Harvard. A confidential memorandum issued by the CIA's Office of Security, which had utilized LSD for interrogation purposes since the early 1950s, suggested that certain CIA-connected personnel might be involved with Leary's group. This prospect was disconcerting to security officials, who considered hallucinogenic drugs, quote, extremely dangerous. Quote, uncontrolled experimentation has in the past resulted in tragic circumstances, and for this reason, every effort is made to control any involvement with these drugs, unquote, a CIA agent reported. The document concluded with a specific directive. Quote, information concerning the use of this type of drug for experimental or personal reasons should be reported immediately. In addition, any information of agency personnel involved with Drs. Alpert or Leary, or with any other group engaged in this type of activity, should also be reported, unquote. It is known that during this period, Leary gave LSD to Mary Pinchot, P-I-N-C-H-O-T, a painter and a prominent Washington socialite who was married to Cord Meyer, a high-level CIA official. Meyer oversaw the CIA's infiltration of the U.S. National Student Association and the Congress for Cultural Freedom in Europe, which provided financial support to numerous Cold War liberal intellectuals and writers. Leary and Pinchot struck up a cordial friendship during her occasional visits to Cambridge in the early 1960s. She asked him to teach her how to guide an LSD session so she could introduce the drug to her circles in Washington. Quote, I have this friend who's a very important man, she confided to Leary. He's very impressed with what I've told him about my own LSD experience and what other people have told him. He wants to try it himself. Leary was intrigued, but Pinchot wouldn't tell him who she intended to turn on, nor did she inform her LSD mentor of her marriage to a CIA bigwig. Leary explained the basic rules about set and setting, emphasizing the importance of a comfortable, sensuous environment for an LSD trip. From time to time, Pinchot reported back to him. I can't give you all the details, she said, but top people in Washington are turning on. You'd be amazed at the sophistication of some of our leaders. We're getting a little group together. Leary had no way of knowing that Mary Pinchot was one of President Kennedy's girlfriends and that she and JFK smoked pot together in the White House. Pinchot was murdered less than a year after Kennedy was assassinated and her diary disappeared from her home. When Leary learned of Pinchot's death, he recalled their conversations about LSD. At various times, she had hinted that the CIA was monitoring his activities. Since drug research is of vital importance to American intelligence, Pinchot told him that he'd be allowed to conduct his experiments as long as it didn't get out of hand. But Leary ignored her advice. In the spring of 1962, he published an article in the Journal of Atomic Scientists, warning that Russians might try to subvert the United States by dumping a few pounds of LSD into the water supply of major cities.
Well, of course, we've seen that notion was discounted sometime before with the research that was conducted where it was discovered that chlorine neutralized it, although the CIA at least developed another form of LSD that was not chlorine neutralizable, so to speak. The point here is that not only were there reports from the CIA themselves that apparently, quote, CIA-connected personnel might be involved with Leary's group, but as we've noticed, the wife of CIA official Cord Meyer, Mary Pinchot, or Pinchot Meyer, was involved with Tim Leary in terms of LSD experimentation. She also was involved with President Kennedy in terms of romantic dalliance. The point being here that Cord Meyer was a key CIA official. We talked about Cord Meyer, his interrelationship with the Washington Post crowd, and the death and probable assassination of Mary Pinchot in an archive show entitled Gloria in Excelsis, which details the interrelationship between the CIA, the women's movement, and the news media. And it's worth noting that the diary of Mary Pinchot disappeared after her murder. What's not mentioned here, but what is discussed in the archive show Gloria in Excelsis, is that it was CIA counterintelligence official and Knight of Malta James Angleton who destroyed it. And the possible connection between President Kennedy's assassination and the probable assassination of Mary Meyer. She was shot in such a way as strongly suggests that the robbery to which her killing was ascribed would probably, well, it was not that the case. She was shot once in the body and two times in the head. That's not the usual way that a robbery, someone shot during a robbery is eliminated. At any rate, the interrelationship between Leary, Mary Pinchot, Cord Meyer, the CIA, President Kennedy, Kennedy's assassination, and the probable assassination of Mary Meyer, political assassination, that is something worth speculating about.
All right, and at this point, we are going to take another break and give those of you out there taping a chance to turn it over. You are, of course, listening to Radio Free America number 28 tonight. The Summer of Love and the CIA, or the CIA and LSD, a couple of acronyms that seem to go very well together.
Now, we've been taking a look at the LSD phenomena. We saw, first of all, how LSD research in this country essentially was engendered by the Central Intelligence Agency by the funding for its mind control work. We then took a look at how the people, many of the major figures involved in LSD proselytization during the 1960s, were introduced to that drug via people strongly connected with the intelligence services research into the drug. We last looked at Dr. Timothy Leary, reports of, quote, CIA-connected people being in Leary's group, said Leary's relationship with Mary Pinchot, who was in turn the wife of Cord Meyer, a key CIA official intimate with the likes of Frank Wisner, Alan Dulles, Philip Graham of the Washington Post was part of the Cord Meyer circle, and Mary Pinchot was herself murdered, in all probability a political assassination, very shortly after President Kennedy was assassinated. And recall that she informed Leary that the CIA was, in all probability, monitoring his research. That's intriguing in light of the fact that a key old OSS official was involved with as the department head under which Leary first undertook his research into psychedelics at Harvard University. We're going to take a look at Leary and his intelligence connections, and specifically those of a group that Leary was affiliated with called the Brotherhood of Eternal Love in just a second. First of all, we're going to take a look at the CIA's involvement with the Haight-Ashbury itself, specifically monitoring the Haight-Ashbury and quite probably doing research into it. Returning again to Acid Dreams by Martin Lee and Bruce Schlain. According to a former CIA contract employee, agency personnel helped underground chemists set up LSD laboratories in the Bay Area during the Summer of Love to monitor events in the acid ghetto. But why, if this assertion is true, would the CIA be interested in keeping tabs on the hippie population? Law enforcement is not a plausible explanation, for there were already enough narcs operating in the Haight. Then what was the motive? A CIA agent who claims to have infiltrated the covert LSD network provided a clue when he referred to Haight-Ashbury as, quote, a human guinea pig farm, unquote. Let me repeat that last sentence. A CIA agent who claims to have infiltrated the covert LSD network provided a clue when he referred to Haight-Ashbury as, quote, a human guinea pig farm, unquote. And what better place to establish a surveillance operation than the Haight-Ashbury district of San Francisco? A dozen years earlier in the same city, George Hunter White and his CIA colleagues had set up a safe house and begun testing hallucinogenic drugs on unwitting citizens. White's activities were phased out in the mid-1960s, just when the grassroots acid scene exploded in the Bay Area. Suddenly, there was a neighborhood packed full of young people who were ready and willing to gobble experimental chemicals, chemicals that had already been tested in the lab but seldom under actual field conditions. In addition to the spooks who inserted themselves among the drug dealers, there were scientists with CIA backgrounds who stationed themselves in the acid ghetto for monitoring purposes, unquote. Dr. Lewis Joylen, J-O-Y-L-O-N, Jolly West, an old-time LSD investigator for the agency, rented a pad in the heart of Haight-Ashbury with the intention of studying hippies in their native habitat. So make of the human guinea pig farm statement what you will, and the presence of Lewis, Jolly, and West in the Haight-Ashbury, make of that what you will. The point being, again, that even in the very sort of cultural center of the psychedelic phenomenon during the 1960s and 70s, the Haight-Ashbury district, the CIA was very heavily involved with it, and perhaps, who knows in what capacity they were involved with it or perhaps creating it.
In the course of back announcing some songs, I made a snide reference to the fact that the famous LSD-inspired song White Rabbit is referred to these days as being from the soundtrack of Platoon. I should say that, of course, it is not entirely unjust, because one of the things that was going on very heavily in the 1960s was the use of serious narcotics by American ground forces in Vietnam. The Acid Dream cites figures as high as 15% of soldiers returning from Vietnam as being hooked on heroin. One of the other drugs that was a very popular choice in Vietnam was LSD, and we're going to be talking about where a lot of that LSD came from.
Now we're going to take a look at the organization called the Brotherhood of Eternal Love, which was the largest single underground source of LSD during the 1960s and 70s. It's a group that became very closely affiliated with Tim Leary, as we're going to see. And as to exactly where the intelligence community leaves off and the Brotherhood of Eternal Love begins is something that we are going to determine, and perhaps could not be determined, because the saga of the Brotherhood of Eternal Love is once again totally inseparable from the U.S. intelligence agencies.
Yeah, it's not unlike a hippie Hughes corporation. Reading from Acid Dreams, one type of acid was particularly popular among American ground forces in Vietnam. It was called, quote, orange sunshine, and much of it was smuggled in from Southern California during the late 1960s and early 1970s. Far from the rice paddies of Southeast Asia, a group known as the Brotherhood of Eternal Love was waging its own holy war of sorts in their tireless efforts to turn the world on to LSD. During their heyday, the Brotherhood ran the world's largest illicit LSD ring. Ironically, their base of operations was Orange County, home turf of Richard Nixon, Disneyland, and the John Birch Society. We will see later if that's actually ironic or not. The saga of the Brotherhood of Eternal Love, Lee and Schlein write, is a bizarre melange of evangelical, starry-eyed hippie dealers, mystic alchemists, and fast money bankers. Federal investigators described them as, quote, a hippie mafia of approximately 750 people that allegedly grossed $200 million. But the Brotherhood's secret network of smugglers lived by a code different from that associated with organized crime. They were fired with idealism, committed to changing the world by disseminating large quantities of psychedelics. At least, that's how it was at the beginning. It all started back in 1966, when a motorcycle gang from Anaheim, California, led by a stocky, intense man known as Farmer John Griggs, held up a Hollywood producer at gunpoint and robbed him of his stash of Sandoz LSD. A week later, the bikers dropped the acid on a hill overlooking Palm Springs in Joshua Tree National Park. They must have seen the burning bush, for they threw away their guns and ran around the desert at midnight screaming, "This is it!" The next morning, Griggs and company roared back to Anaheim, determined to begin a new life. They experimented with psychedelics on a weekly basis and dabbled in mysticism. Griggs was the proselytizer, the moving spirit of the group. In the summer of 1966, he traveled to Millbrook to meet with Leary, who was quite taken by the ex-hoodlum. Quote, "Although unschooled and unlettered, he was an impressive person," Leary said of Griggs. "He had this charisma, that sparkle in his eye."
Well, Tim Leary was to hook up with the Brotherhood of Eternal Love in a very close way, as we're about to see. It should be noted that in order to finance that, the Brotherhood of Eternal Love, and we're not going to go into any detail on this, became one of a number of different groups to found a sort of psychedelic religion. They considered themselves a religious organization. They supported their religious activities by, or alleged religious activities, would perhaps be a better way of putting it, by smuggling drugs in a big way. And that's the dealing operation alluded to here as we review or take a look at how Tim Leary hooked up with the Brotherhood of Eternal Love. The dealing operation was already in high gear when Timothy Leary decided to pull up roots and head for the West Coast, the mecca of hippiedom. By the spring of 1967, the Millbrook scene was collapsing. Three rival religious sects, the League for Spiritual Discovery, the Neo-American Boohoo Church, and a Hindu-oriented ashram, had taken up residence at the acid commune, and the entire place was under round-the-clock surveillance by the police. California beckoned, and Billy Hitchcock, the Millbrook patron, decided to move to the Bay Area. He gave Leary a parting check for $14,000 and sent him on his way after evicting everyone else from the estate. Leary and his new wife, a young ex-model named Rosemary, had a standing invitation from John Griggs to visit Laguna Beach. He was greeted by the Brotherhood like a private, heaven-sent prophet, and he acted the part, preaching to the group about love, peace, and enlightenment. Leary enjoyed the adulation as well as the town's mellow atmosphere. He and Rosemary rented a house near the ocean and spent much of their time dropping acid, lolling in the surf, and talking with the hippies on the beach. Take note here, by the way, before we move to the next section, of Billy Hitchcock. That's short for William Mellon Hitchcock, and that's Mellon as in Gulf Oil and the various other large American industrial enterprises, the Mellon family being one of the most prominent and powerful in the United States. Leary's patron at Millbrook, New York, and a fellow who himself had a lot of interesting connections, was a member of the Mellon family.
And again, not unlike Cappy Hubbard, Billy Hitchcock, William Mellon Hitchcock, as Dave so aptly pointed out, was somebody who frequently engaged in the psychedelic activities occurring at Millbrook and, in fact, subsidized the place. It was, in fact, his property, a huge, sprawling mansion and grounds. But at the same time, just like Cappy Hubbard, despite being a, quote, apostle of LSD, William Mellon Hitchcock was still daily bringing in his banker friends, his wheeler-dealer friends, and was, thrust to his shoulders in the world of entrepreneurial capitalism and perhaps, and we'll see later on, some slightly shadier things. So he was another person for whom the turn-on, tune-in, and drop-out axiom failed to hold true.
Yes, I dare say he never sold his Alcoa stock, even though he was preaching love, et cetera, et cetera.
Even though he was preaching the brotherhood of eternal love, as we shall also see. Continuing. All the notoriety surrounding Leary's movements and pronouncements was something of a mixed blessing for the Brotherhood. They were happy to provide living expenses for the acid guru and finance his frequent travels up to Berkeley, where he rented another house. But Leary attracted a lot of attention, which was exactly what a secret dope-smuggling outfit didn't need. Griggs and several of his cohorts decided to establish a second base of operations at a secluded ranch near Idlewild, California. They bought a 300-acre plot at the arid base of the Santa Ana Mountains to provide a safe haven for their extra-legal activities. The Brotherhood occupied a rundown farmhouse surrounded by a circle of 7 teepees and grew their own vegetables, which their wives and girlfriends dutifully cooked. A wooden watchtower camouflaged by eucalyptus trees enabled the dealers to spot any unwanted intruders moving up the winding road to their hideaway. They stayed high all the time, smoking as much as 30 joints per day per person, and dropping acid whenever the spirit moved them.
Next, we're going to take a look at William Mellon Hitchcock, who was, now bear in mind, he was the person who financed, who bankrolled Tim Leary and his LSD commune at Millbrook, New York. That was after Tim Leary got kicked out of Harvard University as a result of his LSD experimenting. And William Mellon Hitchcock not only bankrolled him at Millbrook, but then became the banker to the Brotherhood of Eternal Love and their LSD operation, well, their overall drug smuggling operation. It should be known that the Brotherhood of Eternal Love, as we said, became the largest underground supplier of LSD in the entire world, and we're going to take a look at just how they came by some of that shortly. Of William Mellon Hitchcock, the patron of Timothy Leary and the banker for the Brotherhood of Eternal Love after Leary hooked up with that group, the authors Schlain and Lee write as follows. Hitchcock served as banker for the Brotherhood of Eternal Love, although later he insisted he was nothing more than a financial advisor. In truth, he had a lot to say about how things were done. According to Scully, he was involved in numerous planning sessions at his house in Sausalito. Sometimes after these meetings, they all got stoned and played Monopoly. Mr. Billy always won. But Hitchcock never expected to make big money from LSD. He was in it more for the adventure. He enjoyed his status as behind-the-scenes facilitator who brought people together and made connections. Most of all, he liked to party, and he wanted to see more folks turned on to acid. In the spring of 1968, Hitchcock and acid chemist Nick Sand journeyed to the Bahamas, where they stayed at the spacious mansion of Sam Clapp, that's spelled with 2 P's, chairman of the local fiduciary trust company. Clapp was a college chum of Hitchcock's, and they had been doing business together for years. They arranged for Sand to open an account under a false name at Clapp's bank. Hitchcock and Sand also looked into the feasibility of setting up an offshore LSD laboratory on one of Bahamas' secluded caves, which led some to wonder whether Mr. Billy was on a Dr. No trip, unquote. Fiduciary's hermetic banking provisions also appealed to the likes of Bernie Kornfeld and Seymour the Head Lazar, L-A-Z-A-R-E, directors of the Swiss-based Investors Overseas Services, or IOS, a fast money laundry for organized crime, corrupt third world dictators, wealthy expatriates, and freelance swindlers. We're going to read more about this from a footnote in a second. Kornfeld and Lazar were both acid veterans. Like everyone else, these hippie arbitrage experts needed a broker, and they found the boyish melon heir irresistible. That's H-E-I-R, by the way. Hitchcock took full advantage of his unlimited borrowing privileges at fiduciary. At Clapp's urging, he poured over $5 million into unregistered letter stocks, the kind that aren't traded publicly, but tend to show dramatic gains on paper, associated with the Mary Carter Paint Company, later known as Resorts International. It was the single largest chunk of money raised by Resorts, an organization suspected of having ties to organized crime. We're going to read a footnote about that, too. Resorts International proceeded to build a casino on an exclusive piece of Bahamian real estate called Paradise Island. A star-studded cast was on hand for the grand opening of the gambling spa, complete with tennis courts, swimming pools, albino beaches, and the clear blue waters of the Caribbean. It was New Year's Eve, 1968, and the guest of honor at this gala event was none other than Richard Nixon, who was about to launch a successful bid for the White House. James Crosby, president of Resorts International, contributed $100,000 to Nixon's campaign. Crosby and B.B. Rebozo, Nixon's best friend, mingled with a bevy of movie stars, jet-setters, gangsters, and GOP faithful. Billy Hitchcock was also there, idling among the heavies with drink in hand. And two footnotes about Investors Overseas Services and about Resorts International are provided by the authors. First of all, about IOS. At one point, Kornfeld imagined a critical cash shortage at IOS when there really was none. This set the stage for one of the largest frauds in the history of money. In 1971, an estimated $224 million was siphoned from IOS into the coffers of Robert Vesco, a heroin trafficker and financial contributor to Richard Nixon's 1972 presidential campaign. William Spector, S-P-E-C-T-O-R, a former OSS operative, claimed that Vesco's tangled web of corporations served as fronts for various CIA activities and provided cover for CIA agents. And in a footnote to Resorts International, Eddie Cellini, C-E-L-L-I-N-I, the brother of a longtime associate of Meyer Lansky, served as the casino manager for Resorts International. Louis Chesler, C-H-E-S-L-E-R, another Lansky crony, and Wallace Groves, who allegedly had CIA connections, were both partners in a gambling venture with Mary Carter slash Resorts. In 1970, Resorts International formed a private intelligence corporation called Intertel, which was staffed largely by ex-CIA, NSA, BNDD, Interpol, and Justice Department officials. Intertel rented its services to a wide range of corporate clients, including ITT, McDonald's, and Howard Hughes Sewer Corporation.
Continuing. In addition to his dealings with Resorts International, Billy Hitchcock maintained a private account at Castle Bank and Trust, a funny money repository in the Bahamas that catered to mobsters, entertainers, drug dealers, and Republican Party fat cats, the same crowd that boozed it up whenever Resorts threw a party on Paradise Isle. A certain Richard M. Nixon was among 300 prominent Americans who used Castle to deposit their cash. The bank's clientele included actor Tony Curtis, the rock group Creedence Clearwater Revival, Playboy publisher Hugh Hefner, Bob Guccione's Penthouse, Chiang Kai-shek's daughter and her husband, and billionaire eccentric Howard Hughes. Castle Bank was no ordinary financial institution. Originally set up by the CIA as a funding conduit for a wide range of covert operations in the Caribbean, this sophisticated money wash was part of a vast worldwide financial network managed by American intelligence. Specifically, the agency used Castle Bank to facilitate the hidden transfer of huge sums to finance subversion, paramilitary operations, an occasional coup d'etat, bribery, and payments to foreign informants. Castle played a key role in funding the CIA's secret war against Cuba, a campaign that drew upon, quote, the patriotic services of mob hit teams assembled at the behest of the agency to assassinate Fidel Castro. The syndicate, seeking to return to the days when Havana was the brothel of the Caribbean, had a score to settle with the Cuban president. They also had much to gain from a cozy relationship with the CIA, whose clandestine financial network provided a perfect shield for criminal activities. In effect, Castle Bank was an intelligence front that covered for the mob. Billy Hitchcock wasn't the only figure in the Mellon clan who rubbed shoulders with the espionage community. A number of Mellons served in the OSS, notably David Bruce, the OSS station chief in London, whose father-in-law, Andrew Mellon, was Treasury Secretary during the Depression. After the war, certain influential members of the Mellon family maintained close ties with the CIA. Mellon family foundations have been used repeatedly as conduits for agency funds. Furthermore, Richard Helms was a frequent weekend guest of the Mellon Patriarchs in Pittsburgh during his tenure as CIA director. We're going to read a footnote here about Castle Bank. Castle Bank was founded and controlled by Paul Helliwell, H-E-L-L-I-W-E-L-L, a Miami lawyer with long-standing ties to American intelligence. Helliwell's career as a spook dates back to World War II, when he served as chief of special intelligence in China with the OSS. He stayed in the Far East when the CIA was formed and bossed a bevy of spies, including E. Howard Hunt of Watergate fame. In the early 1950s, Helliwell organized Sea Supply, a CIA proprietary company that furnished weapons and other material to anti-communist guerrillas in the hills of Burma, Laos, and Thailand. Based in the Golden Triangle, this mercenary army cultivated fields of opium poppies, and the CIA was drawn immediately into the drug connection. Helliwell also served as paymaster for the ill-fated Bay of Pigs operation in 1961. A few years later, he set up Castle Bank, serving in a dual capacity as CIA banker and legal counsel for the Cuban Mafia, which prospered by selling Southeast Asian heroin in the U.S. Helliwell's law firm also represented Louis Chesler and Wallace Groves, both partners in Resorts International. So as always, when we get to working with CIA proprietaries and CIA-allied banks, the connections are so deep and fibrous, as Dave put it, as to be virtually inseparable, trying to find out where anything resembling a legitimate or at least an autonomous business leaves off and the CIA and the Mafia begin.
So again, the patron of Timothy Leary at Millbrook and the fellow who served as the banker for the Brotherhood of Eternal Love, William Mellon Hitchcock, has numerous intelligence and organized crime connections, banked at CIA and mob-connected institutions, and so the whole question of the financing of the Brotherhood of Eternal Love and to what extent it was involved with the intelligence community is, again, something very important to ask, and food for thought and grounds for further research. Some of that research we're going to do or present to you this evening. Back to the subject of the Brotherhood of Eternal Love, we're going to take a look now at the introduction of a man named Ronald Hadley Stark to the Brotherhood of Eternal Love. This took place in the summer of 1969 when some unpleasant changes were affecting Timothy Leary and the folks at Idlewild, California. Returning again to Acid Dreams. In July of 1969, Charlene Almeida, A-L-M-E-I-D-A, a teenage friend of Leary's daughter, drowned in a pond at the ranch. An autopsy revealed traces of LSD in her blood, provoking a raid by the Riverside County Sheriff. Leary was charged with contributing to the delinquency of a minor, and five brothers were sent to jail on pot charges. But the greatest setback occurred in early August when farmer John Griggs took an overdose of PCP. Griggs refused medical assistance as he lay dying in a teepee at Idlewild. "It's just between me and God," he muttered softly before passing away. In the aftermath of Griggs' death, there was a shake-up in the Brotherhood hierarchy. A different breed took over, and their approach to dealing was more competitive and cutthroat than before. Robert Fat Bobby Andrist, A-N-D-R-I-S-T, became the kingpin of the hashish operation. His counterparts in the LSD trade were Michael Boyd Randall and Nick Sand, who controlled a network that included over 30 regional distributors. They unloaded orange sunshine in parcels of 80 to 250,000, and the supply was quickly dwindling. Sand wanted to commence another manufacturing run, but he was stymied by a lack of raw materials. Hitchcock's source in Europe had dried up, leaving the brothers in the lurch. It was at this point that a mysterious figure named Ronald Hadley Stark appeared on the scene. The first time anyone heard of Stark was when one of his emissaries turned up in New York to see Hitchcock. The man claimed to represent a large French LSD operation. He was seeking to unload his product through covert channels. Hitchcock, who was then trying to distance himself from the drug trade, directed his visitor to the Brotherhood Ranch. A few weeks later, Stark and his assistant traveled to Idlewild. The brothers were hesitant initially, but after some verbal sparring, Stark proved his sincerity by showing them a kilo of pure LSD. This was a rather impressive credential, to say the least. None of the brothers had ever seen that much acid in one place before. Stark informed them that he had discovered a new quick process of making high-quality LSD. He laid out his plan to turn on the world, not just the West, but the Soviet Union and the communist countries as well. Stark had business contacts with the Japanese mafia, and they could smuggle drugs into the Chinese mainland. He also knew a high-placed Tibetan close to the Dalai Lama. Why not offer him enough LSD to dose all the Chinese troops occupying Tibet? The CIA was then training Tibetan exiles for guerrilla actions in their former homeland, and a hallucinogen would come in handy. The brothers dug his rap. "We were definitely very gullible in believing the stuff he told us," Scully said.
Continuing, Stark's talent as a raconteur was enhanced by an insatiable appetite for intrigue and deception. He was adept at dropping names, dates, and places that would change depending upon the situation. At various times, he passed himself off as a medical doctor, a gourmet cook, a professional chemist, a collector of fine art. Every story he told was slightly different, and no one knew for certain who he really was. His net worth in 1967 was a paltry $3,000, but a year later he was a millionaire. Stark claimed a relationship to the Whitneys, one of America's richest clans, and attributed his sudden wealth to the deft handling of a family trust fund. Stark maintained an expensive apartment in Greenwich Village and liked to dine at the best restaurants in immaculate three-piece suits. Yet, whenever he visited the Brotherhood Ranch, he put on a smelly jalaba or a rumpled shirt and grease-stained tie. 5'8", with a bulging waistline, high forehead, and thick brooding mustache, he could easily come off as a schlub, but his motley appearance belied a ruthless and cunning intelligence. Although only in his early 30s, Stark spoke 10 languages fluently, including French, German, Italian, Arabic, and Chinese. He was, in short, a genius con artist who could talk circles around just about anybody. Stark presented himself to the brothers as the premier fixer, the man who could get anything done. He came across as someone who really knew his way around the world of international finance, claiming to sit on numerous boards of numerous corporations, some legitimate, others illegitimate, that he alone controlled. He promised to use his connections to help the brothers. Stark warned them that buying real estate openly, as they had done, was much too risky, but his lawyers could remedy the situation by hiding ownership in a maze of shell companies. Before long, he assumed Hitchcock's role as banker and money manager for the brothers' dirty cash. But Stark got much more involved than Hitchcock, overseeing the production end of the LSD operation in addition to the finances. As Eminence Grise of the psychedelic movement, he had a lot going in his favor, principally a reliable source of raw materials from Czechoslovakia and an excellent manufacturing facility in Paris, which had already produced large quantities of LSD in crystalline form. The acid was dyed orange so as to continue the Sunshine legacy, and the brothers tabbed and distributed it. Meanwhile, the redoubtable Stark dashed to and fro, attending to various business scams in at least a dozen countries. Like a chameleon, he moved swiftly from underground drug factories and hippie communes to posh hotels and private clubs for the rich and famous. He maneuvered on four continents, leaving a trail of ambiguities at every turn. A master of innuendo and disinformation, he preferred to keep his range of contacts ignorant of each other's activities. Oftentimes, he concealed the fact that he was an American. His European associates were not privy to his affairs in Africa, and those in Asia knew little about his work in the States. The brothers, for example, had no idea that he was running a separate cocaine ring in the Bay Area. Stark compartmentalized the different spheres of his life, managing everything on a need-to-know basis. His modus operandi was not unlike that of an intelligence operative. He often claimed to know exactly how things worked in the espionage community. He said he knew lots of spies, and to some of his friends he even boasted of working for the CIA. It was a tip from the agency, he explained, that prompted him to shut down his French operation in 1971. A few months later, he opened another sophisticated production center in Brussels, which masqueraded for 2 years as a reputable firm engaged in biomedical research. During this period, Stark communicated on a regular basis with officials at the American Embassy in London. He even elicited their assistance while setting up his Belgian drug lab. By the time it was all over, Stark had made 20 kilos of LSD, enough for 50 million doses. It was by far the largest amount of acid ever to emanate from a single underground source, and most of it was sold in the United States. Let me run this one again. This is 1971, by the way. By the time it was all over, Stark had made 20 kilos of LSD, enough for 50 million doses. It was by far the largest amount of acid ever to emanate from a single underground source, and most of it was sold in the United States. So Ron Stark, a man with equally strange political connections as Billy Hitchcock, but with a great deal more mysteriousness in his behavior and movements, throws himself into the middle of the Brotherhood of Eternal Love, takes over the operation, gets involved not only in the money angle but the distribution angle of it, and proceeds to put together 50 million hits of LSD, the largest amount ever distributed.
Right, and again, this is a fellow who functions in a manner very reminiscent of the intelligence community, who boasted of having intelligence connections, and that boast appears to be very, very substantive, as we're going to see in an examination, a closer examination of the career of Ronald Hadley Stark. Continuing with acid dreams. The fact that Stark was wanted on a drug rap in the U.S. hardly put a damper on his international escapades. He spent much of his time in Italy during the 1970s, cavorting with Sicilian mafiosi, Secret Service officials, and political extremists of the far left and far right. Stark's antics took him far afield. Occasionally, he traveled to the Baalbek region of Lebanon, where he negotiated with a Shiite Muslim sect for shiploads of hashish. Stark claimed to be a business representative of Imam Musa Sadr, a powerful Shiite warlord who controlled vast hashish plantations and a private army of 6,000 men. The area under his dominion was said to include training camps used by the Palestine Liberation Organization and other terrorist groups. Back in Italy, Stark rented a small apartment in Florence, but he rarely stayed there, preferring the posh hotels of Rome, Milan, Bologna, and other cities. By day, he carried on as a smooth and successful businessman. At night, he donned a pair of faded blue jeans and a work shirt and mingled with student radicals and other extremists. Moving in left-wing circles was nothing new for Ronald Stark. He had a knack for popping up wherever trouble was brewing. An American expatriate bumped into him on the streets of Paris during the peak of the Sorbonne uprising in 1968. In London, he frequented the clubs and bars that were hangouts for dissident elements, and he made his first appearance in Milan during the hot autumn of 1969, when massive student demonstrations and labor strikes nearly paralyzed Italy. Furthermore, Stark was tight with the Brotherhood leaders who contributed money to the Weather Underground for Timothy Leary's prison escape. Whatever game Stark was playing took an abrupt turn in February of 1975, when Italian police received an anonymous phone call about a man selling drugs in a hotel in Bologna. A few days later, at the Grand Hotel Baglioni, they arrested a suspect in possession of 4,600 kilos of marijuana, morphine, and cocaine. The suspect carried a British passport bearing the name of Mr. Terence W. Abbott, A-B-B-O-T-T. Italian investigators soon discovered that Mr. Abbott was actually Ronald Stark. Among his belongings was the key to a safe deposit box in Rome that contained documents on the manufacture of LSD and a synthetic version of cocaine. There was also a vial of liquid that scientists could not precisely identify. They figured it was something like LSD. Other items seized by police included letters from a certain Charles C. Adams written on stationery with the letterhead of the American Embassy in London. The messages from Adams, a Foreign Service officer, began with a confidential "Dear Ron," and were addressed to Stark's drug laboratory in Brussels, which had been raided in the fall of 1972 by a team of American agents. If Stark's contacts with the American embassy personnel were difficult to fathom, then his association with some of Italy's most notorious terrorists was equally curious. In the spring of 1976, while he was being held in Don Bosco prison in Pisa, Stark befriended Renato Curcio, C-U-R-C-I-O, a top leader of the Red Brigades that had stalked Italy since the early 1970s. Curcio and his radical cohorts apparently had no idea that Stark was an American when they took him into their confidence. As soon as he succeeded in penetrating the underground terrorist network, Stark asked prison officials to arrange a meeting with the chief prosecutor of Pisa. He said that Curcio had told him of a plot to assassinate Judge Francesco Cocco of Genoa, who was scheduled to preside over a trial of 50 Red Brigadesmen. There was also talk of abducting a prominent Italian politician who lived in Rome. In June of 1976, Judge Cocco was murdered just as Stark predicted. Aldo Moro, five times Italy's premier, may have been the other victim. Stark's name would later surface in connection with the Morrow kidnapping and execution.
Before we go on, we might mention that, of course, the Aldo Moro killing and execution, as with so many of these other things, are things we've talked about at great length. The Red Brigades, remember, that we're talking about are an organization that we have found out that were actually founded by Licio Gelli, the arch-fascist grandmaster of the Italian Propaganda Due Masonic Lodge, which was not really a Masonic lodge, but a secret shadow fascist government of Italy comprising a large number of Italy's leading intelligence, military, political, and banking figures. You will notice, again, that for a man who is supposedly just a kind of a wild cowboy drug dealer and con man, Ronald Hadley Stark has a lot of very important friends on the slightly more conservative side of the political spectrum.
Right, and one of the things that's interesting about Ronald Stark, and we're going to go into his Italian doings at great length here with an essay by Jonathan Marshall, one of the interesting things about Stark is his contacts with the ultra-left and the ultra-right. One of the things we looked at in our five-part Radio Free America series about the P2 Lodge in Italian politics was the P2-related Italian secret services habits of controlling terrorism on both the right and the left, one of the major features of the Stefano Della Chiaia-inspired strategy of tension. And it's worth evaluating Ronald Stark here in the context of the five-part series Radio Free America 17 through 21 on the Mediterranean merry-go-round.
Continuing from where Dave left off in Acid Dreams. Transferred to a jail in Bologna, Stark continued to expand his terrorist contacts. During this period, he received a steady flow of visitors from the British and American consulates. Curiously, the U.S. government never pressed for his extradition, even though he was wanted on drug charges related to the Brotherhood of Eternal Love. Stark also communicated on a regular basis with representatives of the Libyan Diplomatic Corps and had a series of meetings with Italian Secret Service personnel. Documents show that he was in direct contact with General Vito Micheli, M-I-C-E-L-I, who received $800,000 from the CIA during the early 1970s while serving as chief of Italian military intelligence. Micheli was later implicated in a series of neo-fascist coup attempts in Italy. It was quite a juggling act, to be sure, and a judge in Bologna eventually sentenced Stark to 14 years imprisonment and a $60,000 fine for drug trafficking. At his appeals trial, Stark changed identities once again, this time passing himself off as Khoury Ali, K-H-O-U-R-I, Khoury Ali, a radical Palestinian. In fluent Arabic, he spelled out the details of his autobiography, explaining that he was part of an international terrorist organization headquartered in Lebanon called Group 14. Stark's appeal failed, and he was sent back to jail. But Italian police took a renewed interest in his case after they captured Enrique Paghera, another terrorist leader who knew Stark. At the time of his arrest, Paghera was holding a hand-drawn map of a PLO camp in Lebanon. The map, Paghera confessed, had come from Stark, who also provided a coded letter of introduction. The objective, according to Paghera, was to forge a link with a terrorist organization that was planning to attack embassies. In June 1978, Graziano Gori, a magistrate in Bologna, was assigned to investigate and clarify Stark's ties to the U.S., the Arabs, Italian terrorists, and other mysteries. A few weeks later, Gori was killed in a car accident. The Italian government subsequently charged Stark with armed banditry for his role in aiding and abetting terrorist activities. But he never stood trial on these charges. True to form, Stark dropped out of sight shortly after he was released from prison in April 1979 on orders from Judge Giorgio Floridia in Bologna. The judge's decision was extraordinary. He released Stark because of, quote, an impressive series of scrupulously enumerated proofs that Stark was actually a CIA agent. Quote, many circumstances suggest that from 1960 onwards, Stark belonged to the American Secret Services, Floridia stated.
That shouldn't come as too much of a surprise in light of some of the activities that we see Ronald Stark involved in. Now, bear in mind, this is the chief LSD manufacturer for the Brotherhood of Eternal Love. This is the man who manufactured the largest single underground source of LSD in history and who was the main supplier of the LSD subculture, I guess one could call it, during the late 1960s and early 1970s. the indications are, not only from Judge Floridia's conclusion, but from the facts as we are about to examine them and have already to a smaller extent, are that in fact Ronald Hadley Stark was a CIA agent. It's interesting that he should be connected to members of the Libyan diplomatic corps. Of course, we've looked at the Libyan situation at great length in various past archive shows, particularly those in connection with the Triple Wilson team and in connection with the Olympics massacre. It's also interesting that he should be buddies of General Vito Micheli. Micheli is a key member of the P2 Lodge, also an Italian parliamentary representative for the MSI, the Movimento Sociale Italiano, which is the Italian Fascist Party. The nominal head of the MSI, at the last word we had, was a fellow named Vittorio Mussolini. And if the last name rings a bell, it's because he is the son of Il Duce. Now, this is an interesting fellow to be hanging around with Ronald Hadley Stark, and as we're going to see, Stark had a lot of other very, very interesting friends. His Middle Eastern connections are interesting. It's interesting, too, that Judge Graziano Gori, who was investigating Stark's ties to the United States, Arabs, and Italian terrorists, should die in an automobile accident. During our five-part series on Italian politics, the P2, the shooting of the Pope, etc., we took a look at the large number of Italian magistrates who either were killed or were almost killed when they began looking into one aspect or another of the fascist activities of Licio Gelli's P2 Lodge.
Indeed. And the Middle Eastern activities, well, it's all very reminiscent of that whole series of I guess you'd have to call them gray agents like Turple Wilson et al., who are obviously doing the CIA's bidding. They are obviously doing things that are useful to the CIA, all under the cloak of anonymity, of being private businessmen. But time and time again, with the contacts in the right places, in the high places, and time again, they are doing what they are supposed to do to further the CIA's aims, but then, of course, they have complete deniability. And the difference here is that instead of talking about the normal arms shipments and assassinations, we're talking about somebody who basically supplied a large portion of the American drug culture that is thought of by most people as being an indigenous part of the resistance to the American right wing in this country.
And again, it should be noted that some of the very same gray areas, the Middle East, the PLO connections, are some of the very ones that not only intersect with the Mediterranean merry-go-round, but that Turple and Wilson were so heavily involved with, as well as members of the Galen Organization and others we've spoken about in past broadcasts. It's also interesting that William Mellon Hitchcock, the banker for the very activities that Ronald Hadley Stark was executing, was, and perhaps the term execute is a good one in the context, as we're going to be looking at Stark some more here after our break. It should be noted, too, that William Mellon Hitchcock intersects with the very same organized crime and Cuban mafia and intelligence connections that the great heroin coup focused on so heavily. Our last two Radio Free America shows have dealt with the Cuban mafia and their inextricable link to the CIA at great length, and it's worth noting that the fellow who is bankrolling Ronald Hadley Stark's LSD activities, William Mellon Hitchcock, the patron of Timothy Leary, is, again, inextricably linked with that very same milieu.
Yeah, it was also interesting that that in the book, Lee and Schlein noted that Stark had told somebody that it was a CIA tip that had led him to close his Paris lab, which in 1971, at a time that coincided almost exactly with the time that the move was being put on the French drug trade by the Nixon White House, ostensibly to shut down the drug trade, but of course, as we have seen in detailed at great length on these broadcasts, in fact, merely to bring the drug trade under the direct control of American intelligence to be used in a more worthwhile way for funding American covert activities. Well, we're going to be getting into Ronald H. Stark's strange cohorts a little more when we get back from yet another break, and that's what we're going to take right now. So don't go away.
Yes, people who eventually hear this via rebroadcast or who are listening to it on tape, the next section will be on the next cassette side after this one.
And in many ways, the sort of black underside of the Brotherhood of Eternal Love, man who almost single-handedly put together the largest shipment for U.S. distribution of acid in history, and who, as we saw briefly at the end of the last part of the broadcast, it was also affiliated with more fascists than you could shake a stick at if you had a real big stick. And we're going to discuss a little further Ron Stark's strange bedfellows.
Indeed, and again, remember, this is the largest supplier of underground LSD in the United States. Now, Resuming here with our discussion of Ronald Hadley Stark, the manufacturer for the Brotherhood of Eternal Love, bankrolled by William Mellon Hitchcock, closely affiliated with Timothy Leary. And for our further information on the career of Ronald Hadley Stark, we're going to deal with an essay, we're going to read actually almost in its entirety, an essay called The Strange Career of Ronald Hadley Stark. This is authored by Jonathan Marshall, currently the editorial page editor of the Oakland Tribune and one of the principal researchers in this field. And again, his essay is called The Strange Career of Ronald Hadley Stark. Name, Ronald Hadley Stark. Occupation, drug chemist and smuggler. Sidelines, intelligence agent, terrorist. Characteristics, 5'6", 180 pounds, chestnut eyes, born April 30th in USA. Fluent in 9 languages, including Chinese and Arabic. Exceptional competence with explosives. FBI number 812-020-E. And then the rest of the notations, I don't understand. I believe that's his social security number. I'm not going to bother with that. Marshall continues, who was this man? To this day, no one but Stark himself knows for sure. A convicted smuggler, an associate of the highest-ranking Italian terrorists, both left and right, suspected of involvement with the CIA and Italian intelligence. Stark remains an extraordinary international enigma, despite years of investigation by authorities on both sides of the Atlantic. The following account of his life pulls together most of what is publicly known about his career. But first, a word of warning. Stark claims that, quote, 95% of what is written about me is absolutely false, unquote. The paper trail on Stark begins with his first entry in an FBI file on the 24th of September, 1962, for filing a false declaration to gain a U.S. government position. Characteristically, however, the facts of the case, and even whether Stark served time in prison, have been lost, despite later efforts by the DEA to track them down. Stark left the United States for Europe in the late 1960s. He helped set up the British and French ends of the Brotherhood of Eternal Love, a pro-drug propaganda and smuggling organization founded by Timothy Leary, which had strong links to the Weathermen. The American end supplied money. The European side manufactured extraordinary quantities of LSD, hundreds of millions of dollars worth, and shipped it illicitly to the U.S. beginning around 1968. In 1969, Stark recruited into his LSD operation one Richard Kemp, a British chemist and, quote, political extremist intent on causing revolution by widespread distribution of LSD to the youth of Britain. Even then, some associates suspected Stark of working for the CIA.
Continuing with Marshall's essay. In November 1971, he opened a research chemistry lab in Belgium, a front for illicit drug manufacturing. His equipment, which cost $300,000, was paid for out of a Swiss account. The lab was closed in October 1974. In 1972 and 1973, he invested $100,000 in 2 drug factories in California. The umbrella for his operation was a Liechtenstein company called Four Star Establishment, which also owned a ranch in California used by Timothy Leary as a residence. Investigating his case was the U.S. narcotics officer, U.S. narcotics agent Thomas Angioletti, and we'll go back to Angioletti in a second, who reported as early as 1971 that Stark had, quote, opened a laboratory to investigate producing LSD. In 1973, he was indicted in California on drug charges, but no extradition request was ever sent. At the trial, defense attorneys for the Brotherhood of Eternal Love remarked on Stark's multiple identity. They entered a document citing different witnesses who knew Stark previously as a doctor, a chemist, a millionaire, and as a secret agent of the U.S. government. By the way, the U.S. narcotics agent Thomas Angioletti investigating Stark's case, according to Marshall's footnote, Angioletti was the agent who, quote, ran Syrian Guns for Drugs kingpin and Banco Ambrosiano intimate Henri Arsène. Arsène had business dealings with, among others, Sicilian mafia boss Gerlando Alberti and the Red Brigades. We should mention real quickly about Arsène that those of you who did not get to hear the Mediterranean merry-go-round shows known in the RFA archives as the Who Shot the Pope series, that Henri Arsène is a very important person. He headed up the world's largest guns for drugs network, known as STIBAM, S-T-I-B-A-M. At the same time, he was being run, as they mention, as a DEA agent. The DEA even helped Arsene to obtain quantities of illicit chemicals for various purposes. Now, STIBAM was intimately connected with the Banco Ambrosiano, the largest Italian private bank, run by Roberto Calvi, who was a member of Licio Gelli's P2 Masonic Lodge front for a fascist government. Roberto Calvi himself, a fascist banker, an intimate of Michele Sindona, another man with connections both to the fascist milieu and also the CIA. And Henri Arsène's operation, STIBAM, operated directly with Banco Ambrosiano and the P2 to further the political aims of the P2's essentially fascist bankers, military men, intelligence officials who had permeated every rank of Italian government. And they ran operations all over the world on behalf of fascist politics, propping up fascist governments, starting fascist insurrections in countries that were governed by non-fascists. And all of this was supported to a large extent by STIBAM's guns and drugs operation. So we have, just by perhaps a strange coincidence, the man investigating Ron Stark for the DEA is also the man who just happened to run Henri Arsène, the Syrian drug lord who was heading up the operation that worked so very closely with the same Italian fascists that Ron Stark just happened to be in close contact with.
Also worked very closely with U.S. intelligence, and there's considerable question as to whether the STIBAM arms for drugs ring was involved with the Iran-Contra arms supply, arms operation. We're going to be talking about that in our Radio Free America series about that. By the way, the information about Angeletti, his relationship with Arsene, and STIBAM's connections not only to the shooting of the Pope, but also to American and Western intelligence, we cover that in Radio Free America shows numbers 20 and 25. Continuing with Marshall's essay. Official investigations of the Brotherhood of Eternal Love Network continued in the U.S. and Great Britain into the late 1970s. The American end of this syndicate was eventually discovered to be heavily involved in arms dealings, particularly in British Leopard tanks, a Middle East favorite, and, quote, vast quantities of small arms ammunition, unquote. And by the way, a lot of the footnotes in Marshall's essay are taken from a British book about the Brotherhood of Eternal Love called Operation Julie. It's published, authored by Dick Lee and Colin Pratt, published in London in 1978. That is a book which hopefully we'll be able to get our hands on at some point in the future. And the Operation Julie, by the way, was what the bust breakup of the Brotherhood of Eternal Love was called, named for the British policewoman who infiltrated the organization. But that's where much of Marshall's information comes from. Again, resuming the narrative, the American end of this syndicate was eventually discovered to be heavily involved in arms dealings, particularly in British Leopard tanks, a Middle East favorite, and vast quantities of small arms ammunition. Stark remained in Europe. Between 1972 and 4, he owned a hovel in Florence. He made the acquaintance in that period of Roberto Fiorenzi, an engineer known as Booby, later jailed on charges of aiding the Fiumicino-Rome airport massacre, which left 32 dead in a Palestinian attack on an Israeli plane. By 1974, Stark was in Milan frequenting ultra-left terrorist circles. Stark was arrested on the 15th of February, 1975, in the Grand Hotel Baglioni in Bologna, in possession of 4,600 kilos of cannabis, morphine, and cocaine. Police also discovered in a Rome safe deposit box rented by Stark documents on the manufacturing process for LSD. Among the other documents found at the time of his arrest were proofs of his ties to several extraordinary people. The ex-president of Ente Mineriano Siciliano, Graziano Verzato, V-E-R-Z-O-T-T-O, the former Sicilian Christian Democratic leader Salvatore Lima, L-I-M-A, the Black Prince Aliati di Monterreale, and that's M-O-N-T-E-R-E-A-L-E, and the ex-head of the Italian intelligence agency SID, Vito Micheli. Now, on those three individuals, namely Graziani Verzato, Salvatore Lima, Aliati di Monterreale, and Vito Micheli, Marshall footnotes as follows. On Verzato, full name Graziano Verzato. Verzato, a Venetian, got his start as right-hand man to Italian oil magnate Enrico Mattei, M-A-T-T-E-I, whose controversial death, the subject of a film by Francesco Rossi, has been linked variously to Sicilian heroin kingpin Tommaso Buscetta, the CIA, and others in Ente Nazionale Idrocarburi. Verzato went on to become regional secretary of the Christian Democratic Party with a power base in Syracuse. Then, after Mattei's death, he became a senator and head of EMS. Verzato appointed the powerful mafioso Giuseppe Di Cristina, a close ally of Buscetta, treasurer of Socimici, S-O-C-H-I-M-I-S-I, a branch of EMS, and was godfather to Di Cristina's son. Di Cristina was forced to resign by the Anti-Mafia Commission. His link to Verzato was first discovered by the journalist Mauro De Mauro, M-A-U-R-O-D-E-M-A-U-R-O, who was kidnapped in 1970, allegedly while on the track of Mattei's killers. In February of 1975, Verzato's receipt of kickbacks from banks controlled by Michele Sindona became public, and he was forced to resign from EMS. Indicted for fraud soon thereafter, he fled to Beirut. He has been the target of assassination attempts, apparently by Di Cristina's gang, which feared he would testify about Di Cristina's siphoning off of EMS deposits with Sindona. And then he cites a couple of sources, including Luigi DiFonso, St. Peter's banker, which we dealt with at great length in Radio Free America 17 through 21. And of Salvatore Lima, the Italian Christian Democratic leader, Marshall writes as follows. Lima began his public career as organizer of sports and games for the DC, that's a Christian Democratic Party, in Palermo. He became mayor of the Sicilian capital in 1958. During his first 4 years in office, 80% of all building contracts went to frontmen for mafia leader Angelo La Barbera, B-A-R-B-E-R-A, later killed by Buscetta, who ensured Lima's election and handled his security. In 1967, he became deputy secretary of the D.C. for Sicily. And of the Black Prince, so-called, Aliata de Monterreale, Marshall writes, born in Rio de Janeiro in 1921, the Sicilian mason Giovanni Francesco Aliata di Monterreale was a monarchist, dropped from the army in 1946 for refusing to swear loyalty to the Republic. One of his allies during these days of monarchist agitation was the American Admiral Ellery Stone, head of the Allied Control Commission in Italy, who hailed from IT&T. It was Stone who directed James Angleton, then of OSS, to rescue fascist Decima Mas leader Prince Valerio Borghese from a death sentence ordered by the partisans. That's Decima Mas was a fascist organization in immediate post-World War II Italy, headed up by Prince Borghese, who we dealt with at great, great length in our five-part series about Italian and Vatican politics. In 1970, Borghese would attempt to overthrow Italian democracy, allegedly with U.S. support. And by the way, that support was more than alleged. The Pike Committee, investigating CIA misdeeds, disclosed that Michele Sindona, the aforementioned P2 banker, was the conduit for CIA funds channeled to the so-called strategy of tension terrorist attacks, including the aforementioned Fiumicino airport massacre, and that was aided by a man named Fiorenzi, Roberto Fiorenzi, another of Stark's intimates in Italy. Continuing with a footnote. Another ally was Edgardo Sogno, S-O-G-N-O, whose Pace a Libertà was CIA-funded, who, like Aliata, would later be linked to the Rose de Vente coup plots against the Italian government. In 1974, an arrest warrant was issued against Aliata for political conspiracy. Note the role of fiat money in these plots, a link to Libya. Interrupting once again, the Rose de Vente coup group involving, among others, Vito Micheli and Michele Sindona was assisted not only by Borghese, but also was receiving arms from Otto Skorzeny. We talked about that in RFA number 19. Continuing, Aliata was elected to Parliament in 1948 after helping to mastermind the massacre of leftist peasants by mafia-backed Sicilian bandit Salvatore Giuliano. He stayed in Parliament until 1960. In later years, he was a member of the PSDI. In the late 1960s, he frequented Malta and Libya. He was tied through Antonio De Angelis to the pro-Deo movement of Andrew Felix Morlion, M-O-R-L-I-O-N, widely regarded as having CIA and CIFAR ties. CIFAR was an Italian intelligence service. Aliata was a leader in the Grand Lodge of Italy, Piazza del Gesù, reborn 1952, along with Francesco Bellantonio, B-E-L-L-A-N-T-O-N-I-O, brother-in-law of P2 member and Rose de Vente plotter Michele Sindona. With help from Frank Gigliotti, G-I-G-L-I-O-T-T-I, X-O-S-S, Generoso Pope, and other CIA-connected U.S. Masons, Aliazza reunified his Black Lodge with the Grand Orient of Italy, Palazzo Giustiniani, and then the sources, all of them Italian, are cited by Marshall. It's worth noting, too, that the connections here of De Monterreale to Andre Felix Morlian are interesting. This is a network of associations. We looked at Morlian as being a probable contributor, key contributor to the so-called Bulgarian thesis through the information he apparently provided to Italian and P2 Secret Service officials concerning the apartment of Mr. Antonovich, the alleged Bulgarian participant in the plot against the Pope. And finally, the last of the Stark associates footnoted by Marshall, the aforementioned Vito Michelli, Marshall writes as follows. Michelli had particularly close ties with the Arab world through his interests in securing Italy's oil supplies. Michelli had particularly close ties with the Arab world through his interest in securing Italy's oil supplies. He developed contacts with Saudi sheikhs, Yasser Arafat, and above all, Muammar Gaddafi, whose life he saved. Michelli was also close to the American embassy, which passed him $800,000 in February of 1972. He used the money to finance a huge right-wing propaganda campaign, apparently spearheaded by the neo-fascist journalist Giorgio Torchia, T-O-R-C-H-I-A. That was hardly a new tack for Michelli, a member of the P2 Lodge. He aided the famous Prince Borghese coup plot of December 8, 1970. He was also, beginning in 1972, an organizer of the Rose de Venti conspiracy, along with Michele Sindona, his longtime friend. So, the thing that's intriguing here is that we find Ronald Hadley Stark up to his eyeballs with the very milieu that we examined in our Mediterranean merry-go-round series. Thomas Angeletti, Borghese, Vito Michelli et al. And the reason that we're reading the footnotes here and the detail that Marshall provides about these associates, we don't want to damn anybody by association, but on the other hand, when someone spends all of their time associating with Italian fascists, U.S. intelligence officers, coup plotters, and so forth, it's difficult to avoid the conclusion that he was of like mind.
All right, continuing with the description not only of who the people that Stark associated with, but the kinds of things that they were involved in. Through Verzotto, Stark apparently also knew Bernardino Andreola, ex-commando in Decima Mas, Prince Borghese's diehard fascist squad formed near the end of World War II, who tried to infiltrate Gian Giacomo Feltrinelli's nascent left terrorist group in 1968 to 1969. These figures have in common roots in a Sicilian, mafia, fascist, P2, Masonic, and Libyan milieu. Note that Gaddafi was a strong financial backer of fascist causes in the early 1970s, and also of Sicilian separatist movements, such as those advanced by banker Michele Sindona and Michele Papa, later of Billy Carter fame. Arrested with Stark were the engineer Fiorenzi and one Franco Buda, who, fearing he would be implicated in something too big, informed the instructing judge of Stark's and Fiorenzi's ties to the perpetrators of the notorious Fiumicino airport massacre. Buda said that Fiorenzi had safe housed at his villa in Siracusa one of the organizers of the plot, at the request of a Sicilian who held a high post in the armed forces, raising suspicions that General Vito Michelli himself had been responsible. Fiorenzi's name has also come up in connection with the neo-fascist Italicus train bombing. In his own interrogation, meanwhile, Stark claimed to be Kuri Ali, a Palestinian. He carried a perfect Lebanese passport. Only later did he reveal his true identity. He also went by the alias Terence William Abbott. Stark said he was part of a powerful international terrorist organization called Group 14, with its headquarters in Lebanon. In prison in Pisa, on drug charges, Stark befriended two top leaders of the Red Brigades, Renato Curzio and Roberto Franceschini, who had worked for Radio Prague. He seems to have been housed near them shortly after several functionaries from the anti-terrorist agency, DIGOS, D-I-G-O-S, visited him in prison. The Red Brigade's leaders took Stark into their confidence, while Stark in turn was informing to Italian authorities. In April 1976, he revealed to the chief prosecutor of Pisa, Giotto Ladu, that he learned from Renato Curzio of plans to kill Judge Francesco Coco. That's right, of course, yes, Judge Francesco Coco, and to kidnap a leading Roman politician. The information wasn't passed on. Coco was killed in Genoa on June 8th by the brigades. Aldo Moro may well have been the other victim.
Continuing. Transferred to a jail in Bologna, Stark gained the confidence of Enrico Paghera, P-A-G-H-E-R-A, a leader of Azione Revolucionario, a left anarchist terrorist organization heavily composed of foreigners. Red Brigade's leaders had encouraged Peguera to get in touch with the American, whom they knew as a Palestinian. Stark impressed Peguera with his extraordinary intelligence, confidence, money, and contacts. Among those contacts were Libyan embassy representatives in London and Rome, some of whom would visit his cell in Bologna. One of them brought Stark a new passport. "You don't imagine I'll be here for long, do you?" Stark told Peguera. Stark helped Peguera escape from prison by conspiring with a prison warden to fake a medical emergency for Peguera's mother. The aim, Stark said, was to lock the Italian up with an international terrorist organization that would attack embassies. Stark had claimed to be a business representative of the most powerful person in Lebanon, one who has 60,000 men at his command. The figure in Acid Dreams, by the way, was 6,000. This leader was the Shiite head of Al-Amal, the Imam Musa Sadr, that's M-O-U-S-S-A-S-A-D-R, who disappeared at the end of August 1978 on a flight from Tripoli to Rome, apparently in an operation ordered by the Libyan Secret Service. The Imam controlled a military camp a few kilometers from Baalbek, where Stark directed Peguera to go. Stark had instructed Peguera also to contact, quote, the director of M. Saudi Banca Nazionale Tripoli, Libya. He was, in fact, president of the Libyan Arab Foreign Bank, which holds about 10% of fiat stock for Gaddafi. Let me read that last sentence again. The Imam controlled a military camp a few kilometers from Baalbek, where Stark directed Peguera to go. Stark had instructed Peguera also to contact, quote, the director of M. Saudi, Banco Nazionale Tripoli, Libya. He was, in fact, president of the Libyan Arab Foreign Bank, which holds about 10% of fiat stock for Gaddafi. Peguera was arrested in Lucca on the 19th of April, 1978, less than a month after Aldo Moro's kidnapping with four other terrorists, the Calabrian Pasquale Vocaturo, V-O-C-A-T-U-R-O, the Roman Renata Bruschi, B-R-U-S-C-H-I, the Spaniard Luis José Cuello, C-U-E-L-L-O, and the Chilean Ernesto Reyes Castro. This led to new terrorism charges against Stark, from whom the Bologna magistrate... Oh, wait, excuse me. There was parts of this essay are sort of obscured. The printing isn't the best. This led to new terrorism charges against Stark from the Bologna magistrate on 11th of October, 1978. Finally, Stark also befriended, while in jail, Maurice Bignami, B-I-G-N-A-M-I, who went into hiding in September of 1970 after working in the same office with two others accused of ties to Prima Linea. Bignami has all sorts of terrorist connections, including to Tony Negi, N-E-G-I, and his Autonomia Organizzata. Thus, Stark, in a sense, united all three terrorist groups, BR, AR, and AO. Prima Linea, by the way, is another left-wing terrorist group in Italy. He united the aforementioned AO, that's Autonomia Organizzata, with the Red Brigades and Prima Linea.
Continuing. But was Stark all the while working for the CIA as an agent of infiltration? Throughout his prison stay, he received letters from various American diplomats. Charles Adams from the London Embassy addressed him as Dear Ron. He regularly received Wendy M. Hansen, a functionary of the American consulate in Florence. And, though accused of crimes in the United States, his extradition was never requested. Stark, like American authorities, denied that he was a CIA agent. But he did tell the interrogating judge, "But do you, Your Honor, know what trouble will befall a CIA agent who admits it?" On June 26, 1978, the magistracy charged the head of DIGOS, D-I-G-O-S, in Bologna, Graziano Gori, to clarify Stark's ties to the U.S., Arabs, and other mysteries. But on July 4th, Gori died in an auto accident. Though originally condemned to 14 years in jail, a sentence later reduced to 8.5 years, Stark was set free on April 11, 1979, by the instructing judge in Bologna, Giorgio Floridia. The judge based his decision on, quote, an impressive series of scrupulously enumerated proofs, unquote, that Stark was in fact a CIA agent. Besides the facts cited above, Stark reportedly also received money from Fort Lee, where the CIA allegedly operated, and possessed a British passport that was neither lost, stolen, nor counterfeit. Florida concluded that, quote, Stark, assigned from 1960 on to the American Secret Services, insinuated himself into the drug scene in the Middle East in order to infiltrate armed organizations, unquote, that were in contact with the, quote, European terrorist central. He fled on April 27th. The Bologna police speculated that he was clandestinely expatriated via a NATO airport in Pisa or Vicenza.
And skipping down in Marshall's essay, Stark's name surfaced again in 1982 in connection with a giant drug ring in which 65 Italians and foreigners were implicated. The ringleader was Dick Van Dyck, 38, of Holland, who organized the traffic of hashish, cocaine, and heroin between Europe and North Africa. One of his lieutenants was Guido Garelli, G-A-R-E-L-L-I, 38, the go-between for the Italian and Dutch gangs. He seems to have been a colonel in the security services of the former Spanish Sahara. According to the authorities, Garelli, now jailed, knows secrets about some of the most explosive events in Europe and the secrets of many police and intelligence organizations. The Italian press has linked him and his partner, Franco Buda, we talked about him above, a trafficker in stolen cars arrested in Spain, to Ronald Stark. Among the others implicated was the prosecutor general of King Hassan of Morocco, Ben Jiluni. Garelli concealed at his house in Algeciras the fascist terrorist Salvatore Francia, a leader of the Ordine Nuovo and a follower of Prince Borghese. Angelo Angeli, A-N-G-E-L-I, a leader of Squadra Il Azione Mussolini, who acquired 250 kilos of hashish and other wanted rightists. So again, reading that last sentence again as it's sort of complicated. Among the others implicated was the prosecutor general of King Hassan of Morocco, Ben Jiluni. Garelli concealed at his house in Algeciras the fascist terrorist Salvatore Francia, a leader of the Ordine Nuovo and a follower of Prince Borghese, Angelo Angeli, a leader of Squadra Il Azione Mussolini, who acquired 250 kilos of hashish and other wanted rightists. Stark ended up in a Dutch jail on charges of drug trafficking and illegally using a radio transmitter. Then he was quietly expelled to the United States, where he was granted bail in San Francisco prior to standing trial on the drug charges stemming from the 1973 Brotherhood of Eternal Love case. But Stark never did stand trial. The Justice Department, claiming that too many years had passed to prosecute the case, dropped charges in December of 1982, or maybe perhaps it's 83, it's cut off here. The whole matter was handled so discreetly that the press never caught wind of his return. So, again, the importance of this man is that he was not only the manufacturer for the Brotherhood of Eternal Love, with all of their interesting connections to Tim Leary and William Allen Hitchcock, this fellow was the largest single supplier of underground LSD in history. And as I think one would say, certainly was an interesting fellow, and the chances of his not being a U.S. intelligence agent, I think, are absolutely remote. And again, note how far we've come from the notion of peace and love and some of the ideals expressed by the psychedelic counterculture. We find now that the trail winds up not only with arms trafficking, which the American end of the Brotherhood of Eternal Love was heavily involved in, but with the very same milieu which we looked at in our Mediterranean merry-go-round. And echoing the statement I made earlier in the broadcast, if that's your idea of peace and love, I'd hate to see your idea of war and hate.
Speaking of the scions of the LSD experience, one of the most important we discussed earlier in the broadcast was Timothy Leary. At the same time that that Ron Stark was moving his laboratories around Europe and hobnobbing with the fat cats of the European fascist and intelligence milieu, Timothy Leary had gone to Algiers in Africa to hang out with Eldridge Cleaver, and among other things, proposed to Eldridge Cleaver the idea of putting on a series of radio broadcasts entitled none other than Radio Free America, interestingly enough. But at that time, the Cleaver had begun to split with the rest of the Black Panther Party, and for whatever reasons, he saw Timothy Leary as a negative influence. Of course, Cleaver himself later went through some rather interesting changes. And basically held Leary under house arrest for a while, and Leary was finally able to ante up enough money with some help from the Brotherhood of Eternal Love that Cleaver's Algerist Black Panthers would allow him to leave. So that's where we find Timothy Leary when we return to Acid Dreams by Martin Lee and Bruce Schlain. As they scrambled to get out of Algiers in early 1971, Tim and Rosemary Leary were aware of the gravity of their predicament. They had no legitimate travel papers, and additional advance money for Leary's book on his prison escape, titled Diaries of a Hope Fiend, was not forthcoming. Whoever could help them at this point became an instant ally. A British woman employed as a stringer for Newsweek introduced the Learys to a well-educated Algerian bureaucrat named Ali, who made no bones about his association with the CIA. Ali promised to arrange exit visas for them. Rosemary wondered if they could trust such a man. Quote, "He's liberal, CIA," Tim assured her, "and that's the best mafia you can deal with in the 20th century," unquote. The fugitive couple fled to Switzerland, hoping to obtain political asylum. Leary spent the first 6 weeks in jail while Swiss officials reviewed his case. Life behind bars was relatively pleasant, thanks to a mysterious benefactor named Michel Gustave Auchard, spelled H-A-U-C-H-A-R-D, who provided Leary with fine wine and assorted delicacies during his incarceration. Described by Leary as a tall, silver-haired gunrunner, Auchard had strong enough lines into the Swiss Council to secure Leary's release from prison. He also had the funds to bankroll Leary in the high style to which he had become accustomed. Leary nicknamed him Goldfinger, and accepted an invitation to stay in Lausanne at his luxury penthouse with an exquisite view of the lake.
So that's an interesting person for Tim Leary to have received assistance from while he was in prison. It's also interesting that he would make the comment about this fellow Ali, that he was liberal CIA, and that's the best mafia you can deal with in the 20th century. And again, bear in mind Ronald Hadley Stark, William Mellon Hitchcock, and the other intelligence connections to the Brotherhood of Eternal Love.
Remember earlier our talking about Mary Pinchot or Pinchot and her apparent death at the hands of the quote liberal CIA wing at the very same time that she was having frequent contacts with Timothy Leary over the subject of LSD, and wonder where Timothy Leary got the idea that the liberal CIA was the best mafia that you could find to hang out with in the 20th century.
It's also worth noting that Philip Graham of the Washington Post was interned at Chestnut Lodge after beginning to become disenchanted with the Operation Mockingbird, the CIA's habit of using and recruiting journalists. And shortly after being Chestnut Lodge was where Dr. Frank Olson was incarcerated, described as a sort of a mental hospital for former CIA agents staffed by CIA people. And just after coming out of Chestnut Lodge, Philip Graham blew his brains out. And the lawyer for his estate was Edward Bennett Williams, who represented Richard Helms, who oversaw MKUltra. And it's an interesting series of associations worth noting here. Just as we see Ronald Hadley Stark intersecting so heavily with the Mediterranean merry-go-round, we see that Timothy Leary intersects rather heavily with some of the old-line Anglo-Saxon Protestants hooked up with the core, one could say, of the CIA, because now the CIA is a somewhat different organization than it was at the very beginning. An interesting thought, and something which is going to kick off the last part of our discussion concerning the CIA and LSD, was provided on the Brotherhood of Love by Henrik Kruger. This, of course, comes from The Great Heroin Coup by Henrik Kruger, subtitled Drugs, Intelligence, and International Fascism, published in softcover by the South End Press of Boston, copyright 1988, and incidentally edited by Jonathan Marshall. Of the Brotherhood of Eternal Love, there's an interesting footnote in The Great Heroin Coup by Kruger. Somewhere among Robert Vesco's memorabilia floats the strange affair of the Brotherhood of Love. Through it, thousands of potential activists were stoned for years on LSD, and enormous profits from the sale of tablets were reinvested through the Investors Overseas Service-Controlled Fiduciary Trust Company. And the thing that's going to key at the last part of our discussion is that interesting comment by Kruger that through the Brotherhood of Eternal Love, which as we've seen is heavily, heavily involved with the intelligence community. Where the intelligence community leaves off and it begins is, at least to a certain extent, sort of an academic academic distinction. And the question being here, if indeed the Brotherhood of Eternal Love was basically, at least in its later stages, an intelligence operation, and its massive intersection with the intelligence community, its involvement in the arms trade suggests that, what motivation would there be for such an activity on the part of CIA? Bear in mind the other critical ways in which the intelligence services generated the flow of LSD into American society.
One of the things that we've talked about before is the fact that during the end of the 1960s, and especially in the early 1970s, massive infiltration was going on throughout the quote protest movement in all its aspects, from the most hardcore to like the Weather Underground, down to the relatively innocuous civil libertarian groups, the anti-war groups, and things of that nature. Now, one of the largest and most raging debates within these groups about their internal politics was the effect of drugs, especially LSD, on the will to political change. And there was a strong feeling among the more politically serious, as they consider themselves among these groups, that LSD was in fact a deterrent to political activity. So it was certainly something that, with the massive infiltration going on, was right in front of the agency all the time in the late 1960s and early 1970s. Reading some more from Acid Dreams, from a chapter appropriately titled What a Field Day for the Heat, from the old Buffalo Springfield song, talking again about what we have just been discussing, which is the role of LSD in terms of its effect on the political culture of the country. The use of LSD among young people in the U.S. reached a peak in the late 1960s, shortly after the CIA initiated a series of covert operations designed to disrupt, discredit, and neutralize the new left. Was this merely a historical coincidence, or did the agency actually take steps to promote the illicit acid trade? Not surprisingly, CIA spokesman dismissed such a notion out of hand. Quote, "We do not target American citizens," former CIA Director Richard Helms told the American Society of Newspaper Editors in 1971. Quote, "The nation must to a degree take it on faith that we who lead the CIA are honorable men devoted to the nation's service," unquote. I won't touch that one with a 10-foot stick. Helms' reassurances are hardly comforting in light of his own role as the prime instigator of Operation MK Ultra, which utilized unwitting Americans as guinea pigs for testing LSD and other mind-altering substances. During Helms' tenure as CIA director, the agency conducted a massive illegal domestic campaign against the anti-war movement and other dissident elements in the U.S. The new left was in a shambles when Helms retired from the agency in 1973. Most of the official records pertaining to the CIA's drug and mind control projects were summarily destroyed on orders from Helms shortly before his departure. The files were shredded, according to Dr. Sidney Gottlieb, chief of the CIA's technical service staff, because of, quote, a burgeoning paper problem. Lost in the process were numerous documents concerning the operational employment of hallucinogenic drugs, including all existing copies of a classified CIA manual titled, quote, LSD, Some Unpsychedelic Implications, unquote. What was Helms trying to hide? The wholesale destruction of these memoranda suggests there may have been a lot more to the CIA's LSD program than the revelations that came to light during the post-Watergate house cleaning of the mid-1970s. Of course, it's highly improbable that the CIA would ever have drawn up a, quote, smoking gun document describing the details of a plot to dump millions of hits of acid on the black market.
Reading again from Acid Dreams. An Italian parliamentary commission recently issued a lengthy report on domestic terrorism that included a section called The Case of Ronald Stark, unquote. The commission asserted that Stark was an adventurer who was used by the CIA. But proof as to exactly when his espionage exploits begin is hard to pin down. If Stark was connected to the CIA from 1960 on, as Judge Floridia suggested, then the entire Brotherhood operation, with its far-flung smuggling and financial networks, must be reinterpreted.
Continuing. It could have been that he was employed, quote, it could have been that he was employed by an American intelligence agency that just wanted to see more psychedelic drugs on the street, Scully acknowledged. Then again, he might have tricked the CIA just like he fooled everyone else, unquote.
That should be taken with a grain of salt.
Yes. Reflecting upon the 60s, a surprising number of counterculture veterans endorsed the notion that the CIA disseminated street acid en masse so as to deflate the political potency of the youth rebellion. Quote, LSD makes people less competent, contends William Burroughs. You can see their motivation for turning people on. Very often it's not necessary to give it more than just a little push. Make it available, and the news media takes it up, and there it is. They don't have to stick their necks out very much. Burroughs was one of the first to suspect that the acid craze of the 1960s might have been a manipulated phenomenon. An opinion shared by John Sinclair, the former White Panther leader, who once sang the praises of LSD as a revolutionary drug. Quote, "It makes perfect sense to me," Sinclair stated. "We thought at the time that as a result of our LSD-inspired activities, great things would happen. And, of course, it didn't. They were up there moving that stuff around. I just cut that word. Down on the street, nobody knew what was going on, unquote.
And again, bear in mind Henry Kruger's his rumination that thousands of potential activists were kept stoned on LSD. An interesting comment on the effects of LSD by the CIA is recalled here in Acid Dreams. As one CIA document instructed, quote, whatever reduces integrative capacity may serve to increase the possibility of an individual being overwhelmed by frustrations and conflicts hitherto managed successfully, unquote. So that essentially is something to mull over as we evaluate possibly why the CIA might have been interested in distributing LSD to its political opponents, in this case, elements of the anti-war movement and New Left.
Okay, now, another section from Acid Dreams, they're talking about the fact that when LSD was first introduced into the above-ground culture, in many places, specifically in Europe, that it was used as a form of therapy for basically aiding people with what they call psycho-exploration, with true psychiatric therapy. But then they're contrasting that with what happened in the United States and Canada, in North America. A different approach, right, Lee and Schlo- and anyway, Schlain, excuse me, a different approach caught on more quickly in Canada and the United States. Psychedelic therapy, developed by Captain Al Hubbard and popularized by Dr. Humphrey Osmond, was geared toward achieving a mystical or conversion experience. The procedure involved high dosages of LSD, precluding any possibility that the patient's ego defenses could withstand psychic dissolution. Now, that's a key phrase right there. The procedure involving high dosages of LSD precluding any possibility that the patient's ego defenses could withstand psychic dissolution. Well, folks, I don't think anybody out there has to have psychic dissolution explained to them. This is not disillusion, but dissolution, meaning to dissolve the psyche.
And again, recalling the other CIA assessment of LSD, and bear in mind that Humphrey Osmond worked with some of the CIA's researchers. He was part of the CIA-funded and supervised LSD research project. Al Hubbard, of course, the Johnny Appleseed of LSD, a lifelong U.S. intelligence agent. And Barry repeating these phrases from the CIA document. Whatever reduces integrative capacity may serve to increase the possibility of an individual being overwhelmed by frustrations and conflicts hitherto managed successfully. Something to think about as a possible motive for the CIA spreading this drug into society. Returning again to Timothy Leary. The use of acid in a recreational context is a far cry from how the LSD pioneers of the 1950s, both the spies and the doctors, originally envisioned its future. It was Timothy Leary who first spoke of LSD in terms of hedonic engineering, unquote. He promoted acid as a sacrament of play, the drug of homo ludens. The American people today are quantum jumps more sophisticated, Leary said recently, about consciousness, about the nervous system, about self-actualization and self-indulgence, about pleasure being itself a reward. Pleasure is now the number one industry in this country. Recreational travel, entertainment, sensory indulgence. There's no question about that being number one. Now that was my goal. And again, once you think about Leary's comments and think about the notion of LSD inclining one toward mystical conversion and so forth, and ask yourself, and it's something we obviously don't have the answer to, but to what extent the CIA's field research on LSD led them to conclude that by promoting LSD use, it would propel a society in this direction, not only propelling people in the direction of mysticism and recalling our work on cults and mind control and the CIA's mind control program, specifically Radio Free America shows 6 and 7, and also thinking about the Reagan era, I guess one could say, the 80s, the me generation and the tendency of people, certainly people, I guess one could say that people have always been selfish, but with the enormous crises facing us in the world today and the preoccupation of so many of the so-called boomers with their BMWs or their trips to Club Med trips or what have you, again, I think it's worth asking ourselves to what extent the CIA's field research gave them the information that promoting the use of a drug like this would incline a social group in that direction.
One who has studied history, even one who hasn't studied history, is quite familiar with the idea that during the height of the sort of savage plutocracy of the Roman Empire, that the populace was kept entertained by, in the famous phrase, bread and circuses. So possibly what we're seeing here is the creative use of a rye bread fungus to help people to make their own mental circuses.
Before we finish up, Nip, let me change the cassette so that people can get this.
And we are continuing the last segment here of tonight's Radio Free America, number 28. Talking about Timothy Leary's rather intriguing comment that a man who once said that he was going to remake the consciousness of society now says that his goal was to get people interested in recreational travel, entertainment, and sensory indulgence. That was his goal, he now claims. So rather interesting.
Whether or not he could be said to have achieved it, I'd say that his goal has been realized.
Yes, somebody or something or some set of conditions have certainly brought our society to that point.
Yeah, or most of us acting together.
Mm-hmm. Okay, continuing on, a little bit more about Dr. Tim. Tim and Joanna, who was his second wife, I believe, split up as soon as he was released from jail. This is in 1976.
That's Joanna Harcourt Smith,
who
broke up his second marriage.
That's right, exactly. She left for the island of Grenada and points beyond. Her confidant, Dennis Martino, died of an apparent drug overdose in Spain in 1975. It wasn't long before Leary turned up on the college lecture circuit, hyping space migration and life extension with the same zeal he once displayed for psychedelics. I might put in parentheses, he's now hyping computer programs for self-realization. His next venue was nightclubs, where he performed as a stand-up philosopher, a self-described cheerleader for change. It was soft stuff by 60s standards, but Leary still managed to stir up controversy in his public and private life. They don't mention it here. One of the ways that he managed to stir up controversy in his public life was by appearing in a series of staged, quote, debates with G. Gordon Liddy, one of the famous arch-fascists of our time.
We'll be talking about that in just a sec.
It was soft stuff. When he appeared as a guest on a TV talk show, Art Linkletter called the station. Linkletter, whose 20-year-old daughter committed suicide in the mid-1960s, blames Leary and LSD for her death. In February 1979, Leary showed up at, quote, an LSD reunion in Los Angeles, hosted by Dr. Oscar Janiger. An animated discussion ensued among the 30 psychedelic pioneers who attended this private gathering. Dr. Humphrey Osmond and Laura Huxley were there, along with Sidney Cohen, John Lilly, Willis Harmon, and Nick Purcell. The legendary Captain Al Hubbard, Cappy Hubbard, then 77 years of age, swaggered into Janiger's home wearing his security uniform with a pistol and a bandolier around his hip. "Oh, Al, I owe everything to you," Leary greeted the captain. "The Galactic Center sent you down just at the right moment." To which Hubbard responded, "You sure as heck played your part." It was the last time most of them would see the captain, for he died a few years later, not long after receiving a card from President Reagan wishing him a happy birthday.
And of Tim Leary, of course, that is the Johnny Appleseed of LSD. One wonders why Ronald Reagan would wish him anything. That's not the usual sort of company Ronald Reagan would keep, one might think. Of course, as we've looked at in this five-part series about the intelligence community and narcotics, and concluding tonight with LSD, it is absolutely impossible to separate out our national security establishment from the drug epidemic, which President Reagan has been so vociferous in condemning. Continuing with Tim Leary and his post-LSD career, a few years later, he went on tour with his old nemesis, G. Gordon Liddy. Both men had come a long way since the Millbrook days, when Liddy first made a name for himself by arresting the high priest of LSD. Liddy went on to work for CREEP, Committee to Re-elect the President in Washington, serving as a plumber and hatchet man for Nixon. In this capacity, he proposed dosing columnist Jack Anderson and other enemies of the Nixon administration with an LSD-like substance. After doing time for his involvement in the Watergate break-in, he gladly teamed up with Leary for a tongue-in-cheek debate that caricatured their former roles. So, as to what one would make of Tim Leary and the entire LSD experience, again, I think as with Tim Leary, as with LSD, where the intelligence community leaves off and he begins is something of an academic decision to make.
Well, that brings us to an end, the information section of the broadcast tonight, and to the end of this particular Radio Free America mini-series on drugs and intelligence. What we're going to do before we go out the door and before we share one last psychedelic music experience with you is we're going to give you some information on where you can get a hold of these tapes if you were unable to unable to record tonight's broadcast, or if you're interested in getting some back broadcast that you may not have been able to tape before.
All of our archive shows are available from a tape duplication service called DAVCORE. That's spelled D-A-V as in Victor, K-O-R-E. They're located at Suite 1300D, as in DAVCORE, Space Park Way, three words, just like it sounds. That's in Mountain View, California, and the zip code is 94043. The phone number is area code 415-969-3030, 969-3030. Write or phone to the attention of Paul. Once again, DAVCORE, Suite 1300D, Space Parkway, three words just like it sounds, Mountain View, California, 94043. The phone number, area code 415-969-3030, write or phone to the attention of Paul. And neither Nip nor myself nor this station makes any money off of this operation. This is simply intended FYI. For your information.
That's right. And the book that we used in such a large amount tonight was, again, Acid Dreams by Martin Lee and Bruce Schlain, S-H-L-A-I-N. And it's copyright 1985, published by Grove Press. So we gave you a lot of the good stuff, but there is other stuff in there. And we also used, of course, The Great Heroin Coup by Heinrich Kruger, which is a real favorite of ours and a wonderful book. And if you don't have a copy of that one, you better go out and get one post-haste. So with that, unless you have some finishing comments?
No, I just, we've sort of been playing with a sense of bitter irony a lot of the musical hits that became very popular during the so-called psychedelic era, and we're going to conclude with a bitterly ironic song, which was very popular and became one of the anthems of its time, and I think it's worth listening to the words and considering Tim Leary's and the other LSD proselytizers' inextricable links with the intelligence community as we listen to the lyrics of the following song.
That's right. So since you have tuned this in, we are going to turn it on, and Dave and myself, Nip Tuck, are going to drop out. Thanks for joining us for Radio Free America.